One, two, three, four.
Looking for back-to-back wins. Hi, everyone. Mike Tirico. Welcome to ESPN's Monday Night Football and the last line on week four of this 2006 NFL season. Speaking of last, these two teams were in a very unfamiliar spot last year. Last place. They had won divisions over the few years before that. So what happens? They've got the big-name superstar quarterbacks in Favre and McNabb, both at crossroads. McNabb trying to get the leadership back and his health back. He's looked that way so far this year. And Brett Favre, is this just a victory lap for the Hall of Fame guy, or can he get these young guys rallied around and start some sort of a special role? We'll see them try to answer those questions again here tonight. Joe Theismann and Tony Kornheiser, we know they're big names. We know they're really good, but they also thrive on this stage Monday night.
Monday night belongs to Brett Favre. He is a dead solid lock, first ballot Hall of Famer. Yet what we've been hearing for a year has been, when will Favre get out of the way so the Packers can look at Aaron Rodgers? Me, I don't know Aaron Rodgers from Mr. Rodgers, and I don't care to look at him as long as Favre is upright. Prideful, defiant, singular Brett Favre has been the face of the Packers since 1992. That's 15 seasons, or since Aaron Rodgers was seven. In that time, Favre has started 225 straight games at quarterback. Like Trent Green, quarterbacks get carted off the field every game. These guys are meat back there, and somehow Favre keeps going. Favre playing football, Cal Ripken playing baseball, Joan Rivers on the red carpet. There's your Iron Man. Sure, Favre has lost a little off his fastball, and sure, Favre throws into double and triple coverage too often. But after playing Hamlet about retirement, Favre has finally come clean. He wants to play football no matter how lousy his team is. He wants to be out there slinging it, trying to make something big happen, raging against the dying of the light. Good for him, good for us.
And glad that we could be here. Also, there's another guy in this game, by the way, Donovan McNabb. Donovan McNabb wants to do two things. He wants to prove determination. That's why he came here early. And he also wants to go out and show the drive that he has, because he doesn't like the fact that his football team was ranked last in the NFC East. Determination and drive for Donovan tonight, Mike.
As if these two guys don't love and want it, they're going to need to step up in their performances. And Michelle Tafoya and Susie Culver are going to tell you why when we come back on a beautiful night in Philadelphia for the Eagles and the Packers on Monday Night Football. Green Bay has come to Pennsylvania. Michelle Tafoya, Susie Culver covering the teams. Let's start with Michelle covering the Packers.
Well, and what a day for the Packers backfield, Mike. Starting running back Amon Green out with a hamstring injury. He was expected to start until about 2 hours ago when he came out to test his leg. He got through about 3.5 sprints when he just stopped, and he told me the leg just didn't feel like he wanted it to. So in his place will be second-year player Vernon Morency, newly acquired. He's had just 3 yards on 3 carries for the Packers. And this coaching staff must have known they were going to need some help, because they phoned fullback William Henderson, who hadn't even made the trip, was still in Green Bay, and said, "We're flying you up for the game after all." Sort of makes you wonder if running backs coach Edgar Bennett, a former Packer, might put on a uniform tonight. Now for the Philly perspective, here's Susie.
Well, Michelle, the Eagles are dealing with their own running back issues. Brian Westbrook has been dealing with swelling in his right knee for the past 4 weeks. He hasn't been able to practice much, but he has been able to play. Not tonight. During warm-ups, he repeatedly stopped, stretched it out. It was determined he would be inactive. Correll Buckhalter will start. When I asked Donovan McNabb what he will miss most about Westbrook, he said everything. He is the ultimate weapon. Everyone is going to have to step up and do extra. That includes the defense. Their secondary has been banged up. Tonight, they will be without starting right quarterback Lito Sheppard and his backup, Roderick Hood. Mike, that's a lot to overcome against Brett Favre.
I'll say, Sue, so we have no Amon Green on one side, a couple of corners and a running back missing for the Eagles. Tonight's telecast available on ESPN HD, presented by DLP Picture Technology. And kickoff is next. In Philadelphia, temperatures should be in the 50s when business is done around midnight tonight. Packers have won the toss and will receive. Both teams won road games last week. Philadelphia, big lead, gave some of it back, but won at San Francisco 38-24. Packers won at Detroit 31-24. Robert Ferguson, Corin Robinson back deep to receive. David Akers to kick it off. We go from Philadelphia. Robinson runs it down at 9. And the Pro Bowl return man last year with Minnesota, out of bounds at the 25, taken out by Sean Considine. So here he comes, number 4, Brett Favre. Here he comes for one more start. As Tony mentioned at the top, the 225th consecutive start. An NFL record, 140 career wins as a starter. Only Elway and Marino have more. Opening drive of the night from the 25. And your first look at Vernon Morency, former Oklahoma State back with no gain. Green Bay's offense introduced to us by their tight end, Bubba Franks.
Starting up front with the O-line, we got big Chad Clifton and Mark the Biscuit Towson. Moving on to the playmakers, making his 225th consecutive start. This man needs no introduction. Brett the Gunslinger Favre. On to our receivers, Double D, Donald Driver, and the rook, Greg Jennings, Mr. Playmaker.
Franks makes some plays in his own regard. Coming off an injury play, go 5. After no gain, here's Favre's first pass attempt. It's a little check to Morency. And he is right near the first down line. Looks a hair short.
Amon Green is not playing. Obviously, Morency's filling in for him. Amon Green is a guy that has been the heart and soul of the running game here. 58 attempts, 215 yards. He is somebody that Brett Favre can count on. Besides just running the football, when you have a veteran back there, and as much as the Packers throw, protection becomes very important. That's where I think they'll miss him the most.
Just an eyelash shy of the first down. It's 3rd and inches. And Darren Howard claims movement on Bubba Franks. Looks to be correct. Scott Green, our referee tonight.
False start. Offense. Number 88. 5-yard penalty. 3rd down.
So now it's 3rd and 5 and an eyelash.
This is the spot in a game where Jim Johnson, the defensive coordinator of the Philadelphia Eagles, loves to bring pressure. And what I mean by pressure is linebackers, defensive backs. He likes to bring a lot of people in this situation.
In 3rd down situations, you see a lot of 23 for the Packers. Noah Heron, 2nd year out of Northwestern. And Favre's throw is incomplete. Just a little bit too high for the rookie Greg Jennings, and we'll have 4th down. Jennings, the rookie out of Western Michigan, has made a big impact in the early part of the season. Couldn't pick that one up. And here's John Ryan. Kicked in the Canadian League. Beat out B.J. Sander to get the job. And he's the punter. Reno Mahe back deep to receive. Good kick. 59 yards. Takes Mahe back to the 11. And Reno hits it hard. To the 40. Penalty marker down. The return of 29 may come back a bit.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 89, return team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
So I'm Matt Schobel, the backup tight end. So a longer field for Donovan McNabb to work with. He makes his 92nd NFL start, and he's won them at a pretty good clip. 62 of those starts have been victories, and you know, McNabb was so much in the eye of the storm last year with Terrell Owens and the Eagles soap opera that has now moved to Dallas. Don't forget, he was significantly injured and struggled a bit because of that, which short-circuited his season about halfway through.
That seems to be the revisionism, that they blame it less on T.O. and more on McNabb being hurt last year.
And their drive will start from the 15. And without Westbrook, the toss for Dante Stallworth is incomplete. Here's the Philly offense, introduced by their big offensive tackle, John Runyon.
The key to the game is to control Green Bay's front seven. That's our job up front. Physical and domination is the only way to get it done. Backs and receivers' job is to spread the field and make the job easy for the quarterback. That's what we're looking for tonight.
And a lot of that will fall in the backfield on Karell Buckhalter, who has missed two of the last 3 years with a torn right patella tendon in his knee. It came through the preseason, tested, and ready to go. And Buckhalter only gets a yard there. Well, Joe, you answered the Amon Green issue. Now we've got Brian Westbrook, and what is Philadelphia missing? Perhaps the best multidimensional running back in the NFL.
You miss his versatility. What he can do is he can create matchups in the secondary and on linebackers that you can't with other players. Plus, there's a familiarity and a comfort level that Donovan McNabb has with him. Those two things are critical to moving the football for the Philadelphia Eagles.
How about that? 6 yards a run, 11 yards a pass reception in the first three games this year. Westbrook had been performing at a very high level. 39, the Packers bring pressure. And they get to McNabb. Kabir Bajabiamila, who makes a living of getting sacks on Monday Night Football, gets another one. Fourth down.
Talk about what they missed with Westbrook. I had him in fantasy tonight. I got so lucky that I won outright yesterday, and I didn't need him today. When I found out he was scratched from the game, I called everybody in the league. I tried to get another player. They said, shut up, you've won.
Well, if you have the Packers defense, Bajabiamila comes up with his 11 and a half sacks on Monday Night Football in 11 games. Impressive number. Punt return by Charles Woodson, who is stopped immediately at the 46-yard line. So Green Bay will have good field position as they get it back after the stop by the Eagles. Favre on the field when you come back. Green Bay picked up 21 yards on that exchange of punts and very nice field position here, starting at their own 46 for the second drive of the night. Favre to the air. High, but brought in by the rookie Greg Jennings. He was pushed out of bounds at the 32-yard line. First down, Brian Dawkins knocks him out. Gain of 22.
When you get field position like this and you're a young football team, what you want to do is you have to take advantage of what's there. You must be able to convert. Now you get help from your wide receivers. This is what happened early for them last week, getting a big play out of Greg Jennings early in the ballgame.
Sheldon Brown, the starting quarterback who's healthy tonight, was there. Jennings on the quick slant to the 25, and that was in front of Jose Leo Hansen, the backup corner. Here's Jeremiah Trotter to introduce us to the rest of the Eagles defense.
Up front in the trenches, you got Darren Howard, Darren Walker, and Mike Patterson. At linebacker, you got DeHoney Jones, Matt McCord, and myself, a.k.a. the Axeman. In the secondary, you got Mike Lewis and Brian Dalton, a.k.a. Weapon X.
Far third throw is up in the air and caught by Brandon Myrie, who gets the first down. Myrie was activated Tuesday. He was in Denver's camp, and he's a fullback who they are grooming to replace William Henderson.
How do you think Favre feels right now? He just completed a bunch of passes. Last week you mentioned Jennings has already caught two. After Jennings made that big move for a touchdown, Favre was jumping around the field like he was 25 years old again.
And he said it's kind of reassuring to do that again. It had been a long time since Favre had been in the end zone. Most of his passes last year appeared to be intercepted.
First down from the 18. And Morency hauls it in. Out of the McCoy arm tackle, flag down. As Morency gets out to the sideline, and Favre getting up slow after the big hit by Darwin Walker. Was it late?
The only reason Favre was able to get this pass off was because he was in the
personal
gun.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. At the distance to the goal, first down, throwing the quarterback to the ground.
Darwin Walker comes right up the middle. Remember, he got two rookie guards. After he has him in the grasp, he throws him to the ground. Defensive linemen, linebackers, safeties have to understand that if you get the quarterback in the grasp and you even look like you're slamming him down, you're going to get a flag. That's the rule, so you may as well get used to it.
Looks like the way the ref pushed him away, said, get out of here, I'm calling this penalty on you.
First and goal from the 6. Ball throws this drive. Favre just airs it to the first row.
Going back to what I was talking about before in terms of Favre having that jubilation, what he talked last week when he threw some touchdown passes, he talked about the fact that there were times in the 90s when he had as many as 20 touchdown passes in the first 5 games. Said he had 20 all of last year. He's been on both sides of that, and he felt great that he was getting touchdown passes early in the season this year.
He's thrown the last 7 snaps. Make it 8, make it Driver, incomplete. Donald Driver ruled on the field that he never had possession. Philadelphia trying to negotiate a catch and a fumble, but it's 3rd down.
When you're a young football team like the Green Bay Packers are, you can't squander opportunities. You really have to concentrate, focus, make catches, make plays. This one to Donald Driver to the right of your screen. Brett gets it there, puts it right in his belly, and he winds up dropping it. He thinks it's a touchdown. He starts that semi-leap that you were talking about.
Yeah, right.
That's a semi-celebration.
That's a half Lambo.
David Martin, 2nd tight end, near side slot. Eagles bring 4. Favre to the end zone. Driver out of the back, incomplete. Hung on this time, tries to negotiate, the foot was down, but not buying it.
Well, what he's trying to do is he's trying to sell the referee on the fact that he was pushed out. And you have to be able to come down inbounds. His body is at such an angle that they felt like he was going to go out. He does get 1 down, and not quite the 2nd. To me, it looks like he was forced out. There it is right there. Barely gets him. And I think if he had both feet closer, or one of them, might have gone his way.
Force out on those type of plays, not reviewable. Dave Rayner, 2nd-year kicker out of Michigan State, knocks through the field goal, and Green Bay does take advantage of the good field position with a 23-yard field goal. When the landed cheese steaks, some of the cheese heads got in, and they see their Packers get on the board first with a field goal.
Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of Super Bowl 41. The all-new Mazda CX-7, the SUV you never saw coming. Olive Garden, when you're here, you're family. And Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the beginning. Witness the birth of fear in theaters October 6th.
Ben Franklin, high above the city of Philadelphia. Our aerial coverage tonight brought to you by Goodyear. From the former capital of the United States, where the Declaration of Independence was signed back in 1776.
What was that like, Tony?
Hard for me to remember. My TV was out that year. I didn't see it well.
Rayner's kickoff is short. Return from the 11. And Dexter Wynn bounces it to the outside. And we'll get to the 36-yard line to give the Eagles decent field position. Michael Montgomery pushes him out of bounds. See if McNabb and the Eagles can get something going. 5 minutes in, 1st quarter. 9 o'clock here in Philadelphia. The Eagles have gone down to Green Bay 3-0 in the early going. Philly 2-1, trying to stay a half step ahead of the Dallas Cowboys in the NFC East, who happen to come here next week. If you're just tuning in, the big headline of this game, the running backs to support Donovan McNabb and Brett Favre are out. No Amon Green for the Packers tonight. No Brian Westbrook. big-time receiver to help McNabb put up those stats. It's going to be Burrell Buchalter and Ryan Motes doing a lot of the running here tonight, and the carry out to the 30, just shy of it, or 40, I should say, for Buchalter. Well, if you go back, and I mentioned earlier where Donovan McNabb is in his career, through his first 91 regular season starts, 92 is tonight, very eerie similarity in his numbers with Favre. One more win, number of playoff appearances, NFC Championship game appearances, and Super Bowl appearances. Favre won that first one, and in the season where Favre started his 92nd game, they went to the second Super Bowl and lost to the Broncos and John Elway in San Diego. Lots of time. Complete for the 36 to Dante Stallworth, who came over in the trade from New Orleans in the preseason.
That's a big-time play by Donovan McNabb, who came to camp this year determined to make big-time plays even in the preseason. I believe that he is under more scrutiny than any player in the NFL. I believe he sits in the hottest seat of any player in the NFL because of what happened last year here with Terrell Owens. Not so much the injury to McNabb, which clearly was crippling to the team standpoint, but because Terrell Owens said, in essence, Donovan McNabb was not the leader of this team, and McNabb had to reestablish leadership credentials.
Gain of 26, Stallworth had it against the ground a little bit. Double reverse is in the hands of Reggie Brown. Breaks through a tackle, brought down by Brady Papinga. After a good gain on first down, A.J. Hawk, the linebacker, introduces us to the rest of the Green Bay defense.
We'll start with the D-line. Bring the pressure off the edge. We have Kabir Baja Biamila. On the other end, we have Aaron Campman. Then we move to the linebackers. We have this guy led the team in tackles the last 3 years, Nick the General Barnett. And then the secondary, we have four-time Pro Bowler, Charles Woodson.
Woodson from Michigan, Hawk from Ohio State, the fifth overall pick in this draft. Got his first sack in the NFL last week. On second down, McNabb is pressured and the pass is dropped. Incomplete, needed to be held onto by Reggie Brown. And a penalty marker down in the secondary.
I like the way Bob Sanders, the defensive coordinator of the Green Bay Packers, is calling this game. Playing a little bit soft on first and 10, coming back with bringing pressure on second down, sort of anticipating that Andy Reid's going to want to put the ball in the air.
This looks like a big penalty.
Personal foul, face mask, 31, defense. After distance to the goal, first down.
That's former Eagle Al Harris, the cornerback. Got Dante Stallworth.
Now keep in mind, that's who Dante Stallworth beat on that big pass reception just a play ago. And Al Harris evidently didn't like the fact that Dante got off on the cleaner release before it.
So he tried to yank his hat off?
Tried to take his head off.
Yeah.
You know, with those chin straps, the head is inside the hat.
Thomas Toupe, the fullback out of Minnesota, is the lone back here for first down. And McNabb's pass complete to Reno Mahe. He stopped the seven. Brady Papinga started it. Marquand Manuel in the secondary helps finish.
I want to go back to this notion of what Donovan McNabb wanted to do with his team. He was quoted before the season ever began saying, this is a Super Bowl team. We can change 6-10 to possibly 13-3 or 14-2. He wanted to go out and tell the world that he was in charge of the Philadelphia Eagles, that they were going to start fast, that they were going to have a breath of fresh air. And clearly what was unspoken there is that Terrell Owens was no longer here, and it was Donovan McNabb's team again. And by the way, they've done well. And he's having a great season so far.
Second and three, Buchalter, first down, pounds forward inside the five and down to about the 3 yard line.
Tony, Donovan McNabb has never had to prove that he's the leader of this football team. Just because Terrell Owens thought it, I don't think many other people really considered that.
Some did. Some on the team, because when you talk to him about it, what they say is, that was a bad situation last year.
It was a bad situation, but they still, I don't believe, ever denied the fact that Donovan McNabb is the leader of this football team. But to reestablish it, he stayed in Philadelphia more in the offseason just to drive the point home.
He also talked about family football. Last year, it would have been dysfunctional family football.
Eagles have seven offensive linemen in the game. Buchalter lost the football. Hawk started diving on it with Barnett, and the Packers have recovered. We haven't had a whistle yet, They were trying to get up, could have gotten up and run, but they are stopped, and the fumble by Buckhalter is recovered by Green Bay. Nick Barnett comes up with the recovery.
I always believe that if the quarterback and running back have a fumble on the exchange, it's the responsibility of the quarterback. You have to look the ball in, especially down around the goal line. Things are happening so quick, everybody's moving a little bit quicker. You have to pay a little more attention.
In Philadelphia, where the conversation with Andy Reid, the head coach of the Eagles, with Karell Buckhalter on that fumble. But Joe, quarterback issue.
I believe this is ball's too hot. It's got to be down around the belly. That's on Donovan McNabb.
So far from the Packers takeover, and Morency tries to bring it out from the shadow of the goalpost. Gets out to the 6-yard line.
He is not as familiar with Buckhalter as he is with Brian Westbrook. Would that have been different with Westbrook?
It could well have been.
Show us with the Twinkies. You have Twinkies in your hand.
I got
here.
My Sun Doodles. What happens is if they hit you up here, you're clasping down here.
So yeah,
ball's
got to
be down on the belly.
That's where they'll go if they're Twinkies, right down in the belly after I eat them.
Same spot.
You've also got the shoulder pads up in that area as well to bounce right off. And A.J. Hawk and the rest of the linebacking crew were there to make it happen. Far from the end zone, completes it a couple of yards, just a yard shy of the first down. And so Celio Hansen makes the tackle.
An offense like this against a defense that is as quick as the Eagles, with Brett Favre getting the ball out of his hands so quickly, he's very good at throwing the football from different positions. He doesn't need his feet set like, say, a Byron Leftwich who takes that big stride. Brett can get out of his hands very quickly with a short step.
After the driver reception, third and a yard, and Morency gets the first down across the 15-yard line. You might remember last year, especially the Sunday night game against the Lions that the Packers played on ESPN. Sam Congato had just such a big game and really came out of nowhere and was a feel-good story last year. Well, Sam Congato was traded to Houston, and Morency came back in return. And there you see Vernon's numbers in his background. Here's a player who came in with a little bit of a similarity in the offense that Gary Kubiak installed in Houston. So his ability to transition into the Green Bay offense happened quicker than it otherwise would have. To Driver again. Second catch of the drive, gain of about 6.5.
Mike McCarthy, who's the head coach of the Green Bay Packers, as well as calling the plays, you'll notice that they're just running short routes in front of the backup corners of the Philadelphia Eagles. They're not pushing the ball down the field. They're getting the ball out of Brett Favre's hands quickly, and they're allowing the routes to be run at about 8 or 9 yards. Tough for Jim Johnson, the defensive coordinator of the Eagles, to get after Brett with such short routes.
The 42-year-old McCarthy, who replaced Mike Sherman, came over after a year as the 49ers offensive coordinator, and a first down run for Morency takes it out to the 28-yard line.
You think that's a significant change with Brett Favre in his old age, don't you? That he is willing to throw shorter passes, that he is not looking downfield all the time for some big score.
I think, yes, he's made a more conscientious effort to try and do that. The shotgun has also helped him because it gives him better vision and gets the ball out equally as quick. When you've got two rookies at the guard position in the center, getting the ball out in a hurry is important.
And on first down play action, Favre loads up and completes it to Morency to the 33-yard line. So in the early going, without their big running back on each side, Green Bay's offense looks much more comfortable than Philadelphia's.
Brett Favre is doing a very good job. Fake here, take the underneath coverage. Everybody's dropping back. That's just like a good solid run. Now it's second down and 5. It's important if you're going to throw the ball short to the backs that they get someplace where you can be seen by the quarterback, and it's imperative that they catch the football. That builds confidence for Brett.
Run 5, Morency. He'll be right at the line and have the first down at the 39-yard line. So Morency has proven to be a good back in his very limited role in Houston last year, as paying off again here. And Favre looks no huddle for the Packers now. We got it off from the 39. Morency, the helmet comes flying, gains just a couple of yards. Michelle Tafoya.
Well, Edgar Bennett, the running backs coach for the Packers, told me before the game, here is a scouting report on Morency. Explosive, quick with an excellent, excellent burst and a good downhill runner. You'll see him most often on first and second down with Noah Heron coming in often on third down. But they really like Vernon Morency.
I like your line from earlier, Michelle. Maybe Edgar Bennett could suit up tonight. But Morency was a third-round pick of Houston back a couple of seasons ago. Ran for two touchdowns for the Texans last year. And Favre's throw intended for Bubba Franks is knocked down by Dahani Jones, the bow-tie designing linebacker out of Michigan.
Good coverage. Didn't have a very good year last year. Come back to the right part of your screen. He makes the throw. Excellent job getting that right hand up on it.
Tony, you like his fashion sense, don't you?
I think the bow ties he designs are beautiful. I actually have two or three of them.
Why don't you wear one?
Because I really look like a dopey college professor in them, but maybe in the winter I'll wear them.
As opposed to the intelligent guy you look like now, right? Play 10 of a drive that started from a four. Oh, nearly intercepted and incomplete. It was Roselio Hanson who had a chance to jump the route and come up with the interception, but couldn't hang on.
Roselio Hanson has never tried to catch a ball that was thrown that hard. Donovan McNabb throws the ball. Brett Favre just flat guns us. He is in perfect position to cut off the post. It goes literally right through his hands, and Ferguson almost wound up with the catch.
After a first punt of 60 yards, John Ryan's punt to the 16 is fair caught at the 16-yard line. Well, Favre's already thrown 16 passes, as many as any first quarter in his career. Now McNabb gets a chance to try to match Brett's numbers, trailing 3-0. Beautiful look back at the city of Philadelphia. Packers leading here 3-0. The Eagles, of course, had a devastating home loss to the Giants, 30-24 in overtime. That had Philly all stressed out, but then the bounce back went on the road at San Francisco last Sunday by 14. McNabb and company take over from the 16, and Donovan's throw for Stallworth is incomplete. They wanted a flag and didn't get it.
That time he went to Dante Stallworth, but in the last drive, watch on pass track, the anticipation that Donovan McNabb shows. What he's going to do is he's now prepared to let the ball go. Look at the distance from Dante Stallworth to where the ball is caught. Throws it like a 97-mile-an-hour fastball. Distance travels 29 yards. Not a lot of trajectory on a throw like that.
So the speed of that throw would be the equivalent of a 97-mile-per-hour fastball in the bigs. And Favre is one you talked about on that last play before the punt, how fast he throws the ball. Maybe made it tougher for Hanson to catch. We'll throw back to Buckhalter, who fumbled down by the goal line, but atones for it here to the 45. Second down pickup of 28 yards.
Donovan McNabb and the Eagle offense are so good at executing screens. That was another way to get the ball to O'Brien Westbrook. Carell Buckhalter sets up like he's going to block, catches it. Two guys out front, use both of them. Both the big linemen getting blocks. Big Sean Andrews out there, 40 pounds lighter. He's down to a small building as opposed to two big ones together.
A gain of 28 for the former Nebraska back, Buckhalter, the longest reception of his NFL career. And in the final half minute, McNabb sprints and throws, incomplete, intended for Stallworth. Aaron Kampman, an underrated, not well-known, but very effective defensive end, was chasing him.
Aaron Kampman talked about attacking Donovan McNabb. You have to get him moving his feet. That time he was chasing, so his feet had to move faster than he wanted.
Talk about the comparison, that the pass was the equivalent of a 97-mile-an-hour fastball in baseball. In football, they don't wear a mitt. They have to bring
this thing. They wear gloves.
Yeah, but it's not the same as a mitt.
It's not as small.
It doesn't give you that protection on your hand.
The ball's not as small.
Still hurts.
Second down, McNabb to Reno Mahe. Out of the tackle. Charles Woodson made it, and here's Susan.
You know, Mike, earlier you guys drew the comparison of Brett Favre and Donovan McNabb and the success that McNabb has had in his own right in the early part of his career, which explains why he got so sick of Andy Reid constantly comparing them. But then we find out that Reid used to do the same thing to Brett Favre, but he did it with Joe Montana when he wanted to tweak Brett. Then he would say, Joe used to be able to make that throw. I guess, Mike, it's inevitable to be compared.
And what they both say, Susie, you got to do enough of your own work to have film to show someone else. After 1-3-0, Packers.
The Blitz, Sunday nights in SportsCenter.
Football is the ultimate team game, but those superstars at the quarterback position always give your team the hope that you can win, and they always bring you to the TV. And we have two of them tonight, Donovan McNabb and Brett Favre. There are their numbers. 21 of the 34 first quarter plays were passes by those two. Start the second quarter with 35, and McNabb steps up and throws. It's complete to Hank Basket, a yard shy of the first down. Basket, the rookie free agent out of New Mexico, who was acquired via trade for Billy McMullen. Short of the first down, they'll kick it away.
Mike, the Green Bay Packers are the youngest team in football. And you look at what the job they're doing with their offensive line protecting Brett Favre and the way they're covering the Eagles in every aspect, run and pass. Very impressive for Mike McCarthy's young ball club so far.
So John Ryan comes out to punt again. And rather Dirk Johnson, I should say, beg your pardon, able to pin the Packers back at the 10 as Charles Woodson makes the fair catch. 3-0 Packers, 40 seconds into the second.
ESPN's Monday Night Football is brought to you by GMC. We are professional grade. Courtyard by Marriott. Redesigned by business travelers for business travelers. Samsung, the official HD TV of the NFL. And Men's Warehouse. You're going to like the way you look.
Well, Philadelphia, one of those special sports cities, and that's one of the most special people with the Philly tie in sports history.
Smoking Joe Frazier, the Ali Frazier fights, among the greatest heavyweight fights in history. And then Joe Frazier, of course, became a singer. Joe Frazier in the Knockouts.
That's right.
Not exactly Bruce Springsteen.
Do you have the CD?
Not exactly. I have more CDs than you can count of Joe Frazier.
First and 10 from the 10. And Favre's pass over the middle intended for Franks was almost a Jeremiah Trotter interception. He had one against the Giants. Well, Joe, give me a little feel here, because Philadelphia looks so out of sorts offensively without Westbrook, who's so valuable to them, that maybe this game that a lot of people expected Philly to roll isn't going to be that way.
Well, I think Andy Reid has come out trying to run the ball to prove a point. It's not what he does. He's got to let Donovan and Dad get cut loose, just like Mike McCarthy's done with Brett Favre.
Two tight ends, one back. It's Morancy. And Vernon's out of bounds after only a gain of a couple of third and, you know, mark of the 13. Generous mark. Third and 7 coming up. This is a Green Bay team that was shut out on opening day by Chicago, really embarrassed, 26-0. Favre was scratching his head going, well, what did I come back for?
Yeah, but let's take into consideration what the Chicago Bears did last night to the defending NFC champ Seattle Seahawks. Even without a Sean Alexander, I don't think it mattered.
Then the Packers back at Lambeau the next week, lost to New Orleans 34-27. Go on the road, win at Detroit 31-24. Favre fabulous last week. 340 yards, 3 touchdowns, and smart with the football, like he'll have to be here on third down. Fourth down. Sheldon Brown and Sean Considine in double coverage on Jennings.
What he came back for, as he said, was because he loves playing football. After all of that time ruminating about whether he'd retire, it dawned on him, I can't have this much fun doing anything else, and I've got a limited amount of time with my age to do it, so I'm coming back. He could play next year.
I think he
will.
This
might not be the victory tour.
I think he will.
John Ryan's punt is a good one. It's 54 yards, and Dexter Wynn is back after Reno Mahe got dinged on that last offensive series, and Wynn takes it to the 44-yard line. When we come back, a live visit with Steve McNair of the undefeated Baltimore Ravens on Monday night next week. back, just a long throw off of I-95 here in Philadelphia, where the Packers lead the Eagles 3-0 on Monday Night Football. Susie Culver, Michelle Tafoya on the sideline, Mike Tirico, Joe Theismann, Tony Kornheiser here in the booth. And that is not us.
I used Tony to look like that. I had Tony that hair once 50 years ago.
Well, backed up at their own 10, Favre and company couldn't get a first down, so Philadelphia gets its best starting position of the night. From their own 44, with McNabb under center. And a run for about 3 yards with Thomas Toupet, the fullback, fifth round draft pick out of Minnesota 3 years ago. What a final drive yesterday by the Ravens and Steve McNair. They did it the prior week to pull out a victory. A 60-yard drive yesterday. McNair 5 of 6, 55 yards, the big scramble, and the eventual game-winning touchdown to Todd Heap. Sean Merriman went for the big hit for San Diego, and Heap bounces off, gets in the end zone, and the Ravens move to 4-0 by beating the Chargers. Steve's going to join us here momentarily as McNabb throws complete for the first down to the 43-yard line to Reno Mahe, who's back in the game. And Steve McNair joins us now live from his home. Steve, this season for Baltimore had a lot of expectations, and a lot of them were based on you turning around the feeling around that team on offense. How gratifying is it to get off to this 4-0 start?
It's great to get out to a 4-0 start. I think at the same time, you know, you got to look at what this club had before me. They had a great defense and a great offense. They just needed a leader on offense to come in and just manage the football game. And I think that's what I bring to this ball club. We got a good chance of winning a lot of ball games this year.
We know that you are from Mississippi and Brett Favre is from Mississippi. We know you guys are pals. I wondered, when you saw Brett wondering about whether or not to retire, did you think he might actually retire, or did you think he'd be back this year, Steve?
I thought, my honest opinion, I knew Brett was going to come back just because the competitor that Brett is on the football field. And what would Brett do without football? We all know. I don't know. What would he do? But I think at the same time, you know, Brett is a guy that's very competitive. He's going to go out there week in and week out and prove that he can still play this game.
Steve, hang on there a second. McNabb's pass intended for Reggie Brown was incomplete, and Charles Woodson of the Packers took the worst of that, and he's shaken up. So as they look at him, Tony, go back to you.
Yeah, I want to continue on Brett for a second. You are a big guy, yet you have been hurt often in your career. Brett Favre, 255, 225 straight starts at quarterback, Steve. How do you account for that, and what do you think of his ability to keep playing?
Well, I think, you know, there's just a competitive nature that he's got. I think at the same time, you know, you have to look at what Brett has accomplished in his career. He loved his game. I think he's going to continue to play as long as his physical tools allow him to play. And I think, you know, Brett is very smart. You know, if he knew that he couldn't play this game physically or either mentally anymore, he'll retire. But I think Brett's got at least 3 or 4 more good years in him.
3 or 4?
We talked about it. It may not be done after this year. Hey, Steve, we're talking about Donovan McNabb and Favre so much here tonight. And by the way, Favre's teammate Charles Woodson walking off under his own power. You know, McNabb was telling us yesterday how he is so impressed how you have kept fighting through the adversity and the things you can control. As you have watched Donovan McNabb handle his situation here, especially Terrell Owens last year, I'm curious how you see McNabb responding to that. And I'll get your answer after this third down play. 3rd and 8 from the 43-yard line. Woodson out. McNabb throws middle, and it is caught for the first down at the 25 by the tight end L.J. Smith. Healthy 17-yard pickup to keep this drive alive, Joe.
L.J. Smith has become the crutch that Donovan McNabb leans on. He just waits and waits and waits. Nick Collins is in very good position, but we saw Brett Favre squeeze one in right in his hip pocket. He reaches out and just can't quite get the ball.
Packers with personnel confusion. They're able to get 11 on. And McNabb's throw is complete. Once again, it's L.J. Smith taken out of bounds at the 4.
Blown coverage by the Green Bay Packers. Anytime you see someone running that open underneath, it means that the linebackers have gone too far. Could be in an area where you have an A.J. Hawk, a young rookie, gets wrapped up in trying to cover somebody, chasing someone down the field. All of a sudden, L.J. Smith is running wide open.
And McNabb and the Eagles, much like Favre and the Packers on an earlier drive, trying to take advantage of the personnel advantage, staying no huddle. Buckhalter. Just a couple yards to the two. The ball came out again. Second time inside the five. Buckhalter loses it, and the Packers have recovered.
This one's not on Donovan McNabb. It's on Rust. Correll Buckhalter has not played a lot of football.
A.J. Hawk comes up with the recovery. The hit starts with Barnett and Woodson. It was heard earlier, recovery by Hawk. Steve McNair still hanging with us. He'll be back with us on the other side. Another Eagle turnover. Well, while we were away, Andy Reid talking to Correll Buckhalter. Hey, you're running down on backs. Going to need you here tonight. Second time, once an exchange issue there, a clear fumble. And in replay, watched it very closely. It was a fumble. The ball came out. Packers take over at their own three. And Vernon Morency comes off the goal line out to the 9-yard line. Here's one more look.
Okay, this is an obvious fumble. His knees are not down. This is 14 points. This is two fumbles giving away the ball inside the 5-yard line. That's 14 points. This is not a charitable city. I mean, they're not going to, the people in this stadium are not going to want to see him get the ball again. Is Andy Reid going to give him the ball again, Joe?
No, I think Andy Reid. I think Andy Reid had to start throwing earlier. I think he's handed off too much as it is.
This one guy, I know he's been hurt for years, he just fumbled away 14 points.
Only touched the ball 19 times coming into this game.
Second and four. Morency put it on the ground, and the Eagles come up with the recovery. Darren Howard gets in there now and makes sure they have it on the bottom of the pile. No official signal yet, and they do. So I'm on Green out on the Green Bay side. And Morency, with only three carries all year coming into the game, he drops it and gives it right back to Philly.
Okay. Obviously, there's something wrong with the ball. Nobody can touch it. Does Buckhalter get his hands on the ball right here? Does Reid say, take it in yourself?
No.
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 Okay.
Throw the football. Play action fake. Throw the football. Put the ball in the hands of the guy that produces. And on that fumble, what happened on that one was he tried to grab the ball instead of allowing Brett Favre to put it in. I think we have to go back to the Twinkies.
So there you see how McNabb has been over the last three-plus seasons in the red zone. And here's Philadelphia with a quick opportunity to make up for the bad taste off the Buckhalter fumble. From the six, about to be Miller, hits McNabb. Smith can't hang on, incomplete. LJ down by the goal line.
That pass right there has been a difficult pass for Donovan McNabb to complete this year. For some reason, he's been throwing these in the ground. He got it out before. I mean, yes, it could have been caught, but yeah. It's a low pass, and he's been throwing those just outside the hash mark, whether it's a running back or the tight end. They're coming in low.
Three receivers in the game as Hank Baskett joins Dante Stallworth at the top. McNabb, quarterback draw. McNabb, quarterback touchdown.
The guy that gave him the biggest hug, Correll Buckhalter. Donovan McNabb using his athletic ability. He doesn't run near as much as he did before, but he still has the power to be able to land forward.
Probably, they're probably better off with the ball in his hands there than anybody else on the team. Even Peyton Manning is scoring this year. You don't see that often anymore.
A plethora of quarterbacks running for touchdowns.
Akers adds the extra point. That is one way not to fumble the handoff inside the five.
Yeah.
No exchange involved. McNabb scores. We asked Steve McNair about Donovan McNabb. We'll get back to Steve live from his house when we come back. Back here in Philadelphia, we are in Denver next Monday night. Broncos off the bye week. Ravens off the victory over the Chargers. That's 4-0 Baltimore and 2-1 Denver. 8:30 Eastern for Monday Night Football. Of course, our coverage all afternoon starting at 3 Eastern on ESPN. David Akers kicks it off. And Robert Ferguson brings it back to the two. as he's brought down at the 28-yard line. One last one with Steve McNair. Steve, you closed your eyes not to see those fumbles, right?
Absolutely, I do.
Hey, back to the Donovan McNabb point we were making. You know Donovan very well. How do you think he has handled all the stuff he had to deal with last year, injury and Terrell Owens?
You know, I think overall Donovan's done a great job of coming off those bad things that him and Terrell Owens had last year, and especially injury. I think he handled it just like any other quarterback with a lot of class. You know, and I think it shows this year he came back determined, and he's having a great beginning of this year. So it's great that he's doing that, and it's great he bounced back from that injury.
Favre trying to bounce back from his tough season, completes it there to Greg Jennings to the 35-yard line. Steve, we look forward to seeing you next Monday against the Broncos, and thanks for taking the time to join us tonight.
No problem. Looking forward to it.
Okay, Steve. Steve McNair and the Ravens off to a terrific 4-0 start. Ray Lewis and Scott, the defense up to great things so far here in Baltimore. Meantime, Favre from the Packers keep the offensive pace going from the 35, second and three. Looking for that quick slant again. Jennings hits it for the first down. A penalty marker down. The pickup, if it stands, is 18 yards, and this flag's in the secondary.
That's a double punch post, or double pump post. Brett Favre wants to go to him early.
Holding. Defense. Number 22. The penalty is declined. First down.
Hansen's having a tough time with Jennings. Jennings may be a rookie, second round pick. But he's the kind of a player that the coaches kept saying every day in practice he'd make another play. Didn't know his name, but sure recognized his plays.
Quickly, Green Bay into Philly territory. Donald Driver gains 4 on this one to the 41. And here's Michelle Tafoya with more on the other wide receiver.
Well, the other wide receiver is helping the other wide receiver out. Donald Driver making that catch and loves Greg Jennings and his consistency at such a young age, and says tonight was really the night he was looking forward to see if Greg Jennings takes more pressure off of him so the Driver can get more catches as well, guys.
And Jennings has done that throughout the season. A couple of touchdowns. Driver, one of the most thrown to receivers in Brett Favre's fabulous career. Morency probes and finds the first down across the 35 to the 34.
One of the things you don't see the Green Bay Packers doing that we see a lot of teams do is move a lot of people. See a lot of wide receivers in motion. By not moving a lot of people on the offensive side of the ball, it helps the offensive linemen figure out who to block. Keeps everything a bit more stable.
Love the Packers' tempo here tonight. Operating as a confident offense, even though they trail by 4. Complete to David Martin, one of the 3 tight ends. Dehani Jones and Sheldon Brown bring him down.
You got to figure it's hard to almost lose a yard when you hit the tight end with a pass. Mike McCarthy changing it up, putting Brett Favre under the center, back in the gun.
Second down, screen, Morency caught it, Matt McCoy catches him.
They're going backwards here on the last 2 passes.
That one's a loss of 4. You'll have 3rd and about 14 coming up.
They keep completing these kinds of passes, they'll be back at their own goal line.
Jim Johnson.
You don't want to do that.
Jim Johnson, the defensive coordinator of the Eagles, has to bring pressure on Brett Favre. Cannot let him sit back there, and if he does scramble, buy time and get somebody open down the field.
Favre puts it in the belly of Noah Heron. Nowhere to go for the 3rd down back. So Favre adjusted the play, but Philadelphia's defense was ready for it. That show of pressure didn't come. Michael Lewis and company forced 4th down. Let's see. Try a long Dave Rayner field goal here. He's got a big leg, and he's going to be out here to attempt a 50-plus yarder.
You miss this, you're going to give the Eagles really, really great field position.
Officially, the attempt will be 54 yards. Got the leg to make one of these. Absolutely dead on Dave Rayner. Good from 54 yards. Equaling a Green Bay team record for field goal length. Ryan Longwell went to Minnesota in free agency, and Rayner, who beat out Billy Cundiff in camp.
That would have been good from 54 and a half.
Looked like one of your
maybe
drives,
55.
Tony. Looked like one of your drives.
It's great.
Straight as a string, 55 yards.
2005, two kickers were drafted. The Jets took Mike Nugent, and Rayner was taken, and he shows he was worthy of a draft. Big pick there. All right, emails at NFL.com, ESPN.com, Monday Night Surround. For Tony, out of Walter Payton, Jerry Rice, Brett Favre. Tony, who's the best football player ever from the state of Mississippi, Austin in Mississippi?
It's going to be very difficult for me to make a joke out of this because I think this is a serious thing. If I had to pick, I would pick Jerry Rice because I think a lot of people think he may be not just the greatest wide receiver of all time, which is almost unanimous, but maybe the greatest football player of all time. You get in that conversation. So if it was me, I'd go Jerry Rice over Payton, over Favre, and you? And you?
I'd go Jerry Rice, Favre, and Payton.
And Mike?
Yeah.
Rice.
Yeah, you have to go Rice.
Yeah, you got to go Rice Payton, one.
You look Favre. At the you yeah, look at the tough. Records, the Man. Numbers, the touchdowns that he has alone with the few opportunities that he had to actually handle a ball in a game.
And multiple Super Bowl rings as opposed to the others. Multiple. The others had one each, I believe.
So after a tie, the Chris Jackie and Ryan Longwell long field goal record, Rayner forced to make a tackle on Dexter Wynn, who came across the 40 and out to the 47-yard line. 46, I beg your pardon, with a very nice kickoff return.
That's a good look, isn't it? That is a good look.
Oh. 34-yard return. One more email for you here, Tony. What are the odds of your foam cheesehead surviving tonight if you're a Packer fan at the game? Cliff from Orlando.
Yeah, I want to give a little historic perspective here because at the Vet, it would be no chance.
The old stadium.
Yeah, at the old stadium, that person would be buried with the cheese foam head at that point.
Next
this
to the
seems
jail.
To be a more civil place, does it not? And it's early in the season, and they don't hate the Packers like they hate the Redskins or the Giants. So I'd say it's about a 10% chance. Those people, there's safety in numbers, I suspect.
McNabb on first down, looking deep for Stallworth. Incomplete. He and Ahmad Carroll had a little thing going on the last play that was the Eagles' touchdown, and they were in one-on-one there. Yeah, it doesn't have that feel of Veterans Stadium.
Well,
where it,
right, where they... That was the first stadium, I believe, to put in a holding cell.
Yes, correct.
Veterans Stadium.
Just out of the outstretched arms of Dante Stallworth. Been a big addition. 11 catches coming in. 20-plus yards per reception. Two touchdowns.
And Ahmad Carroll's been a much maligned player in his third year out of Arkansas. His consistency has been a question in his first couple of seasons. Second and 10, Buckhalter for just a couple of yards. Again, if you're just tuning in, Amon Green and Brian Westbrook, such integral parts of each offense, both out. They tried it pregame. There is Green. He's on the sideline. Hamstrings that have been bothering him. Brian Westbrook not out on the field as his knee that prevented him from practicing most of the week. He tried it a little bit Saturday and before the game, but he is not available to Andy Reid.
And their value has been, the point has been driven home by the Eagles fumbling the ball twice and the Green Bay Packers fumbling it once.
Third and 9, needing to get to the Packer 44. McNabb down the middle, intended for Hank Baskett, and there was Charles Woodson on coverage. Donovan wants a hold. It's fourth down.
Just to make that point about where the fumbling, and in the most inopportune places, twice on offense inside the five, then the Packers get the ball, and they fumble it right back inside the five. No. They got to rub mud on the football like they do with baseballs. They got
to
do that.
You're supposed to be able to bring. Now you're supposed to be able to bring your own balls.
Yeah,
teams can bring their own balls to the game.
Dirk Johnson, the punt into the end zone, touchback. punt was 53 yards. It'll be Packer ball at the 20, and here's Susie.
Mike, we can probably guess the weight that a Super Bowl ring carries in this league. Andy Reid doesn't have to guess. He wears his Packer Super Bowl ring, even though he says he hates to wear jewelry because it saves him a lot of preaching. When the players don't want to practice in pads, he simply points to the ring. And he said, for what the ring represents, he doesn't mind that it kills his fingers when he shakes somebody's hand.
Of course, earning that when on the Green Bay staff.
You hit it against windows and against the cars. It's a little bit cumbersome to deal with. I'll admit that, but you put up with it.
Oh, Joe, are you suggesting that you, too, have a Super Bowl ring? Is that what you're saying?
Funny you mentioned it, Tony. I was lucky enough to be a part of a team that won one. And, of course, I'm the only guy in the history for Joe Gibbs that actually lost one.
But do you think it's necessary to bring it with you everywhere you go, to all your appearances and every show, the cab drivers, the bus drivers, everybody else?
Eagle block in the back, number 87, 10-yard penalty from the touchback spot. Ball will be put on the 10-yard line, first down.
And Mike McCarthy will see his team now start from its own 10. As the penalties tacked on, David Martin guilty of the infraction there. You know, you saw Mike McCarthy there on the sideline, and it's like you only hire Mikes now if you're going to be a coach in Green Bay. You had Holmgren and Sherman, now McCarthy. They interviewed a bunch of guys not named Mike. They interviewed Jim Bates, former defensive coordinator, Wade Phillips, Tim Lewis, Maurice Carthen, Sean Payton, who eventually became the coach of the Saints, and Ron Rivera. All of those people were interviewed along with McCarthy. And Mike getting his first head coaching job. Never been a head coach on any level. And I think the official made a mistake with whom the penalty was on. I was wondering why he was talking to Green Bay and marking them back 10. But Andy Reid's now finding out that the penalty's on his guys.
But
so it's plus 10 out to the 30-yard line.
Green Bay seemed to accept it, didn't they? They seemed to move back as if it was on them.
You just go wherever the official puts the ball down. Back up at the line of scrimmage.
So the Packers will start from the 30-yard line. And Vernon Morency runs for just a couple of yards. Mike McCarthy, we mentioned, was with New Orleans as the offensive coordinator for 5 years. Then last year with San Francisco. Principles of the West Coast offense. But some of that zone blocking that Denver and Atlanta does is now in the mix here.
But that raised eyebrows because the San Francisco offense was so inept last year. When he was named to Green Bay, a lot of people thought that was a curious choice.
Got his first NFL win last week. Looking to go back to back, win here in Philadelphia tonight. Morency with Jeremiah Trotter joining Darwin Walker on the stop. Left third and about six coming up.
One other thing on Mike McCarthy. Ted Thompson, who hired him for the Green Bay Packers, said he was more interested in the man and the person than he was the X's and O's. Remember, when he was in New Orleans, he had 1,000-yard rushers with Ricky Williams and Deuce McAllister, and 1,000-yard receiver with Joe Horn. He wound up with a rookie quarterback in San Francisco a year ago. So there are reasons why he didn't have the success last year.
Corin Robinson has checked in the game at wide receiver. He caught a 24-yard ball from Favre last week in Detroit. Third down, pressure picked up, complete to Robinson. First down at the 47-yard line. Corin Robinson was in Minnesota. You might be familiar with his story. It's a first-round draft pick. It was taken in Seattle some years ago. Mike Holmgren gave him every chance to succeed, but he kept getting in trouble. Substance abuse trouble. He eventually had to be suspended, then released by the Seattle Seahawks. Caught on before the season started in Minnesota. Pro Bowl kick returning season. Was going to be their number one receiver this year. What happens in training camp? Pulled over doing 110 to 55 and was found to be under the influence. An arrest and things to follow after that. Bubba Franks the catch for Green Bay. First down to the 38-yard line. Michelle Tafoya, there's more ahead on Corin Robinson's situation.
Yeah, he's a stage 3 member of the league's substance abuse policy. That means that another violation would mandate a year-long suspension. Now, alcohol is not among the NFL's list of banned substances, but every player in the program must follow a prescribed treatment plan, and a violation of the prescribed treatment plan is a violation of the program. I hope that makes sense, Mike. The fact that Robinson is still playing suggests that a suspension has been handed down, or if it has been down, he has appealed it, and the appeal will take some time, Mike.
And he's got a legal case to deal with in Seattle's Kirkland, Washington, later on this week. Injury to Michael Lewis on the field, and we'll step out for a minute. The injured player for Philadelphia, Michael Lewis, helped off the field. We remind you the Toyota halftime show is coming up with Stuart Scott, Steve Young, Michael Irvin, and Tom Jackson. They've got a great spot there to watch the game here at Lincoln Financial Field. They'll have their review of the first half. Hello, TJ. Everything going on in sports as well. On first down, Favre gives to Morency. Look at Vernon Morency, very quick through the hole. And he's right at the first down line at the 28-yard line. Back to the injury to the starting strong safety, Michael Lewis.
Michael Lewis comes up and just delivers a blow on Bubba Franks. And Michael Lewis is one of those guys that you have to be careful with him because he hits people as hard and winds up getting the result of it.
2-minute warning, Packers driving at the Eagle 27. Well, Woho, hang on to the ball tonight without the starting running backs in there because of injury. No Amon Green and no Brian Westbrook. Vernon Morency put it on the ground for Green Bay, leading to the touchdown for the Eagles. Brett Favre and Donovan McNabb have been asked to carry more of the load through the air. And thus far, Green Bay has controlled play a little bit better than the Eagles, even though Philly leads by one. At the 2-minute warning, Packers first and 10. Barnes stumbles on back out of there. Incomplete, low for his tight end, Bubba Franks.
The reason why you saw Brett Favre stumble is these young guards are stepping on his feet. That's why the shotgun is good for him, because he gets away from those young guys up front. Guards take that drop step to help out on pass protection, and they wind up stepping on your toes.
That can't be good. It hurts. See, if you're a coach, you have to say, gentlemen, we've got a problem here. Stop stepping on the million-dollar quarterback's feet.
$100 million quarterback's feet. Whatever.
28 play action. Favre gun down the middle. Oh, Donald Driver took a big hit from Sean Considine. Both are shaken up, and the Eagles are running low on DBs. Driver stays down. Considine gets back up. They come to look at Driver.
This is a Brett Favre gun. Donald Driver doesn't even see Considine coming in.
Well, while we have a second, let's get you updated on what's happening in the game. Favre's thrown already 25 times. Could be on the way to another 50-pass attempt game. McNabb has the lone touchdown of the night, a rushing touchdown, after they had fumbled it a couple of times. Twice inside the Green Bay 5. Joe feels that the first one was too high, McNabb putting it up by Buckhalter's shoulder. The second one, clearly Correll, who has a lot of rust on him. He's missed the last couple of years and three of the last four with very serious knee injuries, a torn patella tendon in his right knee each of the last 2 years.
Michael, when you look at the first half of this football game, you get the sense that the Philadelphia Eagles sort of came into this feeling like they were better. I know the coach says, all right, we have to work hard, and Andy Reid saying, look, we can't take anything for granted. They've almost let a couple games get away at the end. They have let one get away. The Green Bay Packers come in saying, we're young. We have nothing to lose, and we have Brett Favre. And I sense a greater sense of urgency out of the Packers than I do the Eagles in the first half.
The Eagles had every right to feel that way, because the Packers secondary has allowed touchdown passes of 49 yards, 26 yards, 35 yards, 37 yards, and 42 yards in the first three games. I mean, come on. They had every reason to believe that they were going to score 30 or more points at that point.
Which is a credit to the way the Green Bay Packers have adjusted.
They've got Donovan McNabb. They're not putting a guy out there who doesn't know how to play.
No, I agree.
No. But with starting running backs out like this, it changes the entire tenor for both teams. You've had three terrible fumbles by reserve backs.
Because of the injury, you saw Driver walk off in the last 2 minutes. Green Bay loses a timeout. They're charged with one. They now have two. It's 3rd and 10. And Favre tries the middle for Jennings. Incomplete. Everybody in green and gold on the far side looking for the pass interference flag. There was none on Joselio Hansen.
Jennings comes inside, At some point, you have to let him go if he passes 5 yards. I tend to agree.
I mean, he wasn't being held.
The guy was over 5 yards. There's a no contact rule, oh, by the way, after 5 yards.
Dave Rayner, first career attempt from 46 yards.
Made one from 54.
First one between 40 and 49.
Nailed that one, too.
You need a guy with a strong leg to battle the cold weather that you're going to run into in Lambeau. And good job, Dave is right. 3 field goals for Mike McCarthy's kicker. It is 9-7 Packers. Donovan McNabb back on the field. We mentioned both quarterbacks very good on Monday nights. Donovan takes us back to one of his Monday night memories.
The play versus Dallas was magical. It was tiring because it was about 14 or 15 seconds. But to top it off with a big play to, you know, kind of put us in a position to score. It was a great catch, great play. You know, you shake everybody's hands, but you know you have to run some more plays in order to get in the end zone.
A very memorable play against the Dallas Cowboys. And there you see McNabb's numbers. And this is his 12th Monday Night Football start. And those are the kind of plays, Joe and Tony, that make us want to watch Favre and McNabb, because no play is truly dead when 5 in the Eagle uniform or 4 in the Packer uniform has it.
There are a lot of good quarterbacks in the league, but these guys are not only good, they're very exciting. I mean, you'd spend money to buy a ticket to watch Favre and McNabb. They're absolutely
fun. They're absolutely fun. They're fun guys. When Donovan McNabb is smiling, things are well. When Brett Favre is running around, he's happy and things
are
well.
You don't even need the other guys on the team. I mean, your eyes do not leave Favre and McNabb. They are stars.
Dexter Wynn had a good kick return last time. This one from the 4. And he only gets to the 15-yard line. That one was well covered by Jason Hunter.
Talked
Robert
about
Ferguson shaking up. I'm sorry, Tony.
Talked about Favre and McNabb being stars. McNabb is a great star in Philadelphia now, but he wasn't for a while. The people in Philadelphia were upset when he was drafted. They wanted the Eagles to take Ricky Williams. He had that flap with Rush Limbaugh that turned into, you know, a story about racial polarity. And then, of course, Terrell Owens, has been the biggest story in the National Football League for over a year now. Everything Terrell Owens does and what he did to Donovan McNabb, one of the reasons why McNabb needed and wanted to come back this year and lead the Eagles quickly to some victories.
You don't think it'll start all over again
next
after
week,
this game next
absolutely.
Week?
Absolutely.
Because the Dallas Cowboys
coming here.
Coming
sure
here.
It will, and that will be a memory that McNabb doesn't want to revisit. McNabb told us that he felt it was comical and that it never bothered him at all. And, Joe, maybe you'll take the side of the player in this one, but I think it's got to bother you where it's always on talk radio. It's always on television. People are questioning you as the leader of the team, and Terrell Owens gins up such a controversy. I can't believe that Donovan McNabb was not negatively affected by that, even though he says he wasn't.
I believe him. You become numb to it. And as Donovan said, it becomes almost humorous after a while.
Well, I don't know that ever became humorous.
You mentioned Robert Ferguson got hurt. Here is how he got hurt, trying to make the play on Dexter Wynn.
Donovan McNabb has to put some spark in this offense. The fans are trying to cheer him on a little bit.
They're also cheering the shot of Ryan Howard, the man who flirted with 60 homers this year for the Phillies, across the parking lot.
Whatever it takes, Mike.
They're trying to
whatever it
find
takes
something
to get, the fans
to get them
cheer.
Going. From the 16, here's McNabb. It's a 3-man Packer rush. Flag comes down as that pass is incomplete, scooting in for Reggie Brown. Flag thrown in the secondary.
Al Harris is going to wind up on that with Dante Stallworth.
Illegal contact. Defense, number 31, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Boy, Stallworth has a thing going tonight with Al Harris and Ahmad Carroll.
Doesn't matter who it is, he's in a thing with them. There's one. Al Harris tries to cut him loose.
Joe, how important was getting Stallworth in a trade in August for this Philly offense?
It was huge. It gave him a big-time receiver with some, I mean, look at the catches last year. 70 catches, 7 touchdowns, had numbers, catch him at a great time and maturity in his career.
Greg Lewis, who had a fumble last week against San Francisco, one of the 4 receivers in. Good job by McNabb on the snap, and the pass is incomplete. Not in the same spot where Reggie Brown was.
Mike, Donovan has thrown quite a few balls today into the ground. When a quarterback is throwing the ball short, it's mechanics, it's your step, it's your footwork. Anytime you get that type of inaccuracy, he steps in and just overthrows the ball. Instead of just trying to throw it naturally, and I'll liken it to a golf swing, instead of just taking a swing at the ball and hitting it, you try and hit it, and it doesn't go where you want. He's trying to throw the ball too hard.
After the incompletion, we have 2nd down and 10. McNabb, who's missed on his last 4, completes this one to Hank Baskett. Out of bounds, 44-yard line. 1st down, Philadelphia. 1:22 to go. Gain of 22.
You could see the difference in Donovan McNabb's delivery. Comes more relaxed, much more under control. Didn't try and overthrow. When you try and overthrow, you get that right foot off the ground too much. Now he drags it with good rotation of the hips and shoulders.
I didn't see any gold pants in that shot either. A nice job by the offensive line giving him time. Mahe back in the game from the 44. McNabb wide open. Reggie Brown. Try to make Carroll miss. Pulled down 25. 1st down. Game of 31, timeout Eagles.
He beat him bad. They blitzed one-on-one. Gives him the inside move and then back outside, and he's lost.
That's the Green Bay secondary we've come to know and love lately, right?
So the Eagles use their first timeout. They have 2 left, and we check in with Michelle Tafoya.
Well, Mike, that's exactly one of the things the Green Bay defense is trying to correct, giving up those big plays. And cornerback Charles Woodson told me that communication breakdowns have been responsible for a lot of the defensive breakdowns. If you notice, all the Green Bay defenders are wearing wristbands, either on their wrists or on their belts or their pants. Now, on those wristbands are listed all the defensive plays that they can call. The idea there is they can call, say, a green 6 or a red 4 instead of having to call out the entire defensive play. That's particularly helpful on checks when they're trying to get the play distributed throughout the entire defense. Didn't help them much on that play, though, Mike.
Not at all. 5-plus 20-yard pass plays tonight for the Eagles. Green 6 or not. From 25, McNabb. Pressure picked up. And McNabb's throw too high for a Hank Baskett.
It was Aaron Campman yesterday who told us that the defensive players was going to wear all of these things. And he said that there were, I think, 24 defenses you could call out. And he gave an example. He said, we could say blue 5, red 2, yellow 6. And it was Michelle who said, you just sunk my battleship. Which was a great line. A great line.
McCarthy's defense has given up nearly 400 yards a game this year. 300 yards a game in pass defense. 2nd and 10, McNabb flushed. And brought down by Carroll. Good open field play for the man who went by the nickname Batman when he played at Arkansas. 3rd down.
One other point on the reason why they wear those wristbands is because teams are running no huddle offenses against them, and it allows them all to just get the communication out easily and quickly.
Certainly a league trend we've seen first month of the season. More no huddle. Interesting here, Eagles not using one of their 2 remaining timeouts before this 3rd down. McNabb is flushed by Cullen Jenkins and eventually brought down by Jenkins and brought down at the 36, sending him back to 53-yard field goal range, and he just couldn't take the sack there.
The Green Bay Packers front defense only has 8 sacks. The pressure by the individuals, number 77, Cullen Jenkins, goes right around Harriman and continues to pursue. Those guys are running with a real high motor up front, and the Eagles are going to get a real tongue lashing when they get to the locker room at halftime, and a lot of questions are going to be asked. What are you doing?
Here's a question you can ask. How much do they miss Westbrook right now in his first half?
A lot.
Toyota halftime show, seconds away. Stuart Scott in as Chris Berman is headed off for the baseball playoffs coming up on ESPN. We have the Jacked Up segment, fastest 3 minutes, and the suspension for Albert Haynesworth of the Tennessee Titans, suspended 5 games for his foot facial to Andre Girard of the Dallas Cowboys. So the half will end with a field goal attempt by David Akers.
Mike, that's a good number, too.
5 games?
5 games, yes. Jeff Fisher, the head coach of Tennessee, felt like he didn't need to add any more. I thought Roger Goodell did an excellent job as the commissioner doling out that kind of punishment.
Packers will take a timeout. The eighth-year man, Akers, coming off his poor season. Mike McCarthy, almost a little humor there. You know, Joe, you bring up the Haynesworth play in the point that I think is accurate. Roger Goodell, the new commissioner of the National Football League, this is the first major on-field incident that he had to deal with and comes down with that strong suspension. 2 games was the largest suspension for an on-field when Charles Martin, Packer fans remember, took Jim McMahon and threw him down like a rag doll. And the 5-game suspension coming down this afternoon for Haynesworth.
There's a lot more coverage now. Sports matters a lot more now, and people want to know that you can't get away with stuff like that. And when a new commissioner comes in, the worst thing he can be seen is too light, too ineffective.
I think this.
So if you err on one side or another, you err on the side of being harsher in this regard.
And I don't believe he was too harsh.
For the lead here at the half, Akers from 54. He's hit 10 50 pluses in his career. A fake and a pass. It is to Mike Bartram, and taking out of bounds. Well, it's not Bartram, it's Darren Schobel, beg your pardon. And the half comes to an end. So they throw it to Matt Schobel there, and the boos rain down on Philadelphia as the Eagles head to the locker room, trailing 9-7. Philly gets the ball to start the third. Here's Stuart Scott with the Toyota halftime show. Stu? In a very surprised Lincoln Financial Field, Green Bay leading Philadelphia 9-7. Mike Tirico, Joe Theismann, Tony Kornheiser, Susie Culver, Michelle Tafoya down on the sideline, and Donovan McNabb and the Eagles were driving toward a score to perhaps at worst take the lead 10-9 going into the locker room. Instead, the sack, they backed up, and then the curious decision for the fake field goal and the pass that was completed to Matt Schobel, gained 11 yards, but
had to be a mistake.
Didn't do much else.
Had to be an on-field adjustment call that was a mistake with 1 second to go.
It's bizarre. They needed 45 yards. He got 11.
Eagles get the ball first. Deep kickoff by Dave Rayner, and no return coming for Philly. Guys, I know Brian Westbrook's not there. I know Amon Green's not there. But right now, the absence of the important back who carries a lot of the load has been more detrimental to Philadelphia's cause right now than Green Bay's.
It has. The inconsistency in the running back. Tony, you brought it up. The 2 scores that they would have had had Carell Buckholder hold on.
They gave him away.
The other thing is Donovan McNabb has not been very accurate. Mm-hmm. He's done it on a couple of occasions, but not with consistency. He's going to have to throw the ball better in the second half for them to put some points up.
It's very surprising to me. I'm one of those guys who thought the Eagles had an enormous advantage with the Green Bay secondary being what it was. I would have thought the Eagles would be up substantially by now.
I think the Eagles thought so, too.
That's right.
Well, McNabb in the offense starting from the 20-yard line. And the pass is well covered by Nick Collins. Incomplete. Intended for L.J. Smith, the tight end.
Donovan McNabb has spread the ball around in the first half, thrown it to a lot of different places. Not a lot down the field. 10 of 19 completions. You look at the distances. You know, over 15 yards. He's tried but without hardly any success. I mean, he's tried to hit every aspect of the field in every quadrant, but not a lot of success.
The Eagles unable to get a running game going, so a lot in the air, and Reggie Brown is blanketed by Ahmad Carroll. And Joe, the need to throw maybe one of the deep balls and loosen up these Green Bay corners, it might be evident from that pass chart, because they're sitting on a lot of the short stuff right now.
Oh, Mike, it's good in theory, but when you've been sacked three times and you know if you're going deep, you have to hold the ball a little bit longer, I don't know if that's on Andy Reid's menu right now.
Third down, Hacker blitz picked up for the moment. McNabb room to run. First down across the 30, and Donovan slides to the 34-yard line.
That's one of the most effective plays of the night. The other really effective play was when McNabb went on a quarterback draw and scored the touchdown himself. Joe, we know he doesn't like to run the ball. He would prefer not to, but at this point, that's the effective play, and it seems to be open for him.
That was the first double-digit yard run of the night for the Eagles. McNabb hasn't had 50 or more rushing yards in his last 32 regular season games. That time, Ryan Motes, who got an opportunity, fell down on his own, and the second-year man out of Louisiana Tech will lose yardage.
Did that look like frustration on McNabb's face as he handed the ball off again to a running back? At least didn't fumble, but didn't make any yard.
The question going through his head was, what next?
Right. I think he's saying to himself, am I going to have to run it all the time and pass it all the time? Am I going to have to do a Michael Vick out here tonight if we're going to win?
The answer is yes.
Second and a dozen. Never touched down, so good job by Brown to get back up. And at the 40-yard line, Ahmad Carroll was so interested in negotiating with the line judge about the ball was should be an incompletion that he forgot to touch him on the ground.
Two-hand touch doesn't work that way. You can't push him to the ground, two hands, and he's down. He's on the ground. Look, he's pointing to the official. Nope. He's not that.
He touched him as after he rolled over, got off a knee, so kept the play alive. This is third down, and Motes, it's the first down out to the 46-yard line. Marquand Manuel the hit for the change move.
The Eagles feel that Ryan Motes is their best pure runner. He runs the ball well, runs low to the ground, not a big guy, 5'8", a little bit like Brian Westbrook in that regard. But when it comes to just purely running the football, he does that well.
They all have all midget backs, right? Aren't they all under 5'10"?
Yep.
The running backs?
6 feet, Carell Buckholder.
Okay. He's on the bench right now. McNabb throws, and that goes through the hands of Reggie Brown. Incomplete. Kabir Bajabia Miller was pushing McNabb back. You know, you talked about Carell Buckholder, the one big back at 6 feet. For the sixth-year man in Nebraska, missed the last couple of years with his knee problems. Put it on the ground twice inside the 10. One may have been the issue of the exchange with McNabb. That certainly was credit. A.J. Hawk on the bottom of the hit and Charles Woodson on the top to force it out. Or rather, Nick Barnett helping to force it out. Second and 10, throw for Stallworth, incomplete. The Eagles want a flag, nothing coming in.
What I like to see, or what I'm seeing now, is the defensive backs know exactly where to look for the back judge to see if anything happens. Contact is away, ball's up. Yeah, a little bit early. But we saw contact before for the Green Bay Packers, and there wasn't. So as this game goes, you say to yourself,
are you saying it's okay to rip a guy's head off?
They're letting them play a little bit. The officials have made the decision to not call this one as close, and they're letting them play a little bit.
Woodson, Carroll, and Harris, the three corners for the Packers, have done a good job thus far here tonight. Third and 10, McNabb needing to make magic happen. Has room to run, fake the throw so he can hold the safety long enough to get the first down. That's Brett Favre's move.
That answers Tony's question. Is Donovan McNabb going to have to do it all by himself? Yes. A couple of Packers have a shot at him. A.J. Hawk comes in clean, not in control. Cohen's not going to catch him. Donovan runs out of bounds after he gets the first down. Donovan's going to get a lot of people tired, including himself.
He's going to be the most tired of all.
Pick up of 11. They've made all three third down conversions on this drive. Again, Buckhalter stays on the bench, and Moats is the running back. It's to the 39-yard line, gain of 3.
Dare I say, making the moats of a bad situation?
You could say it. It would be foolish to say, but go right ahead and knock yourself out. There's some similarities to Westbrook, and you talked about the size, just the ability of Moats to do a lot. Has only 2 carries on this season, both coming in the 49er game.
But he doesn't give him what Brian Westbrook gives him in a passing game. You can't create the mismatch on a linebacker for the big play that you can with Brian Westbrook.
Got the left side this time and tripped up before he could get into fourth gear. Nick Barnett stopped a bigger game, but it is a first down.
That's where the Philadelphia Eagles have to try and attack this Green Bay defense. They play man-to-man outside, so the corners are going to turn and run away. You see Al Harris get out of the picture right away. And it's going to be up to the young linebackers to try and go sideline to sideline to stay with the running backs. If you want to run the football, that's where you have to attack that Packer defense, which has done a heck of a job so far in this ballgame.
This drive started at the 20. Moats has been the featured back.
This is really uncharacteristic of the Eagles to hand the ball off this often. Don't they usually pass close to 70% of the time? And on this drive, it's runs by Donovan McNabb as well as his running back.
Last year they did throw that much.
Led the league last year, and I think they're second this year to the Packers. I mean, you're seeing two teams here, particularly without their great running backs. You'd have thought they could put it up 50 to 55 times each.
They've run it for 47 yards on this drive after running it for 31 in the entire first half. Moats left side again. That time he's held up as Colin Cole and Corey Williams, the defensive tackles, force third down.
Andy Reid curiously just wanting to stay with the run. And when Donovan McNabb goes back to pass, they're still staying with the run, because Donovan McNabb has picked up 2 critical third downs running the football. Everybody going no huddle. Time for the ring to do its magic.
Play 14 of the drive. McNabb complete, and Chipe not brought down, but then the second time as he tried to get back up, Ryan Pickett didn't stop hustling and ends up making the play. So Barnett thought he had him all wrapped up, but Pickett, the free agent who came over from St. Louis, didn't give up on the play. Fourth down, and the field goal unit is on.
They weren't sure whether Ryan Pickett was going to play tonight. Corey Williams started in his place, so he's playing in spot duty. Good pickup. Ryan Pickett, Charles Woodson, Ben Taylor, Manuel, all these guys have come from different teams.
We trust there will be an actual field goal attempt here, do we not?
By David Akers, who faked the one before halftime. The lefty from 40 yards. And Philadelphia takes the lead, 10-9. Field goal drive from their own 20 puts Favre back on the field, down 1. In Philadelphia for one of our 2 Monday Night Football visits. We'll see Carolina in here the first week in December. Here on the first Monday of October, the Eagles offense with Ryan Moats doing a lot of the rushing. A 15-play drive capped off by a 40-yard David Akers field goal to take the lead. And 6 plays on that drive were designed runs, and then you had McNabb run twice for first downs. The Pro Bowl kick return from last year, Corin Robinson from the 1. Unable to get to the edge and brought down at the 20-yard line by Dustin Fox, the former Ohio State Buckeye. Favre back on the field. His team has not scored any touchdowns, but they are very much in this game in Philadelphia.
ESPN's Monday Night Football is brought to you by IBM. What makes you special? NFL.com. Log on and watch all the highlights from every NFL game this season. It's all on NFL.com. Capital One, what's in your wallet? and GM, same company, new tune.
Pat Stakes, founded in 1930, so many famous pictures on the walls over the 7.5 decades of those who have sampled the cheesesteaks. And my guess is a few of those people have sampled a cheesesteak or two in their time.
How about the one you ate at halftime?
A quarter
that
of
count?
One. Yeah. I missed dinner tonight. From the 21, Morency doing the work of Amon Green, who's out with a gain of 7 yards. And here's Michelle Tafoya.
Mike, I spoke with Mike McCarthy at halftime. He likes the way his offense moved the ball in the first half, but he wants to see touchdowns rather than field goals. As for Morency, he really likes this guy. He's happy with him, with the exception of that fumble in the early second quarter. Also, Robert Ferguson, x-rays on his ribs during halftime, but he's been in there on special teams, so no significant injuries there. And Mike, I'll leave you with this thought. Have the cheeseheads tried the cheese steaks?
Maybe the Wisconsin folks brought their own dairy product to add to the meat. Second down, far. A couple of receivers on this side. The long ball, a lot of contact with Driver, and he couldn't get free. It's incomplete.
Brett Favre has the ability to throw the ball from a lot of different positions. Quarterbacks have to transfer weight. They have to get their arm in the right position, unless you're Brett Favre. Both feet on the ground, no stride, winds up with a penalty. On his toes again. He gets it up in the air on his toes with no real step. Now when he gets a chance to cut it loose, he steps into it and fires rockets. That's Brett Favre and the variety that he brings to the quarterback position.
Third down, pressure picked up. Another shot for Jennings. Greg Jennings caught it. Dawkins hit him. Did he have possession and control of the ball before Dawkins knocked it out of bounds?
That should be a catch.
It is. Catch, ball knocked out of bounds, Packer ball, first down at the 40.
We also might see a challenge, but it should be a catch. He catches it, he turns, he runs, the ball gets knocked out of his hands, and that should be a catch. You have to make a football move with it when you get hit.
He's quickly becoming Favre's favorite receiver.
He has, and he's been the coach's too, all through training camp. He doesn't play like a rookie. That's the constant thing you hear about him.
That ball caught, secured. Andy Reid will challenge here. Andy was watching on the big board here. Tom Melvin, his tight ends coach, is upstairs with an eye on the monitor as well, and they decide to force the challenge here and have Scott Green, the referee, take a second look at it.
Philadelphia is challenging the ruling on the field that it was a completed pass.
So a 30-yarder to Greg Jennings or an incompletion? You see, have your opinion for the final answer after this. 30-yard catch or no?
After reviewing the play, the ruling on the field stands. The receiver took 2 steps after gaining possession. Philadelphia is charged with a timeout.
They're down to 2. Andy Reid lost his last 7 challenges on replay last year. This is first one of 06, and he loses this as well.
Gains control with the right hand, then he gets hit after he takes 2 steps.
And as Scott Green stepped under the hood, he had some folks trying to help him.
They got to get a bigger hood.
Hello, Philadelphia.
So first down for the Packers from the 41. This drive, their first of the half, started at the 20. And for the second time, Donald Driver can't catch one of those Favre hot slants.
This is the kind of drive that Favre thrives on. You know, on the road, if it results in a touchdown, you quiet the crowd, you take them out of it early in the second half, you take the lead back. Driver obviously should have caught that. But the signature on some of these drives is one great scramble or one long pass, maybe the one of Jennings. This is what you come to expect from Brett Favre, right, Joe? Scoring points here.
Two tight ends, 2 receivers. The one back is Morency. He puts that head down, keeps going. Decent gain of 5, 3rd and 5 coming up. Joe, how's Brett been spreading it tonight?
Well, Brett Favre has a reputation of being a gunslinger. Gunslingers say you go down the field a lot. He's been a lot more cautious. Look at the completions, 4 out of 5. 3 out of 7, 8 out of 12, under 15 yards. Just 5 passes above 15 yards with the one big completion we just saw to Jennings.
Well, last year he had so many mistakes. When he threw it in the air 20 yards or more downfield to a target down there, he got intercepted 15 times. McCarthy came in to hopefully get some stability and focus back in the offensive decisions. And he said Favre's been very good this year. 3rd and 4. That throw for Driver incomplete. He could not get open, and it's 4th down. So from here, guys, a field goal would be 54 yards, and we saw Rayner make one going this way in the first half. He'll get another chance.
Jim Johnson, when it gets to 3rd down, is bringing pressure. His defensive backs are in the hip pockets of the wide receiver. Brett Favre unable to complete him. If he's going to throw, he's got to complete him on 1st and 2nd down.
If Driver catches that slant, they're not in this position. Can't hang that on Favre.
For his 2nd 54-yard field goal of the night, Rayner wide left. No good. The Eagles able to stop the Packers, and they get the ball in good field position at the 44. Back in Philadelphia at Lincoln Financial Field, 4 miles south of Center City. Straight shot down Broad Street here to the ballpark. You see Favre's numbers, all of his short passes. Meantime, McNabb on half the completions. Neither player is throwing a pick here tonight. After the missed field goal, good field position for Donovan and the Birds at the 44. And a screen throw out to Buckhalter. He'll get a 1st down, chased down by Colin Cole. Let's go down to Susie Calder.
Mike, Donovan McNabb had promised us that for most of this game, he'd be up watching Brett Favre operate. He has so much admiration and respect for him. But when your team is struggling just to stay in the game, I'm sure you're not in the mood. And this is the position, for the most part, that Donovan has assumed most of the game, sitting on the water cooler in the middle of the bench. Gets an occasional visit from a wide receiver. I don't know if he does most of his best thinking there, but the usual upbeat McNabb has looked rather down.
It has seemed like an offense that just doesn't feel itself here tonight. Play action. Deep ball for Greg Lewis. Caught it. That'll make him feel good. Touchdown, Philadelphia.
That's exactly what this Eagle offense needed. It's what the fans needed. They needed to get excited about something. Perfectly thrown ball. Greg Lewis only had 7 catches coming into this game. It's against Ahmed Carroll. No fanciness here. It's a straight line up the field. Go get it. Touchdown.
Don't be shy. You called that. When they came to the line of scrimmage, you said they should go deep here.
They have to. You have to do something at points in the game to get the team excited, get the fans excited. Good call.
45-yard touchdown reception for Lewis. Akers adds the extra point. It is just the 2nd touchdown of Lewis's career, the longest completion of his career. Donovan McNabb, who's had so many big 20-yard plus pass plays this year, adds another one. Well, the tone has changed amongst 68,000 here at Lincoln Financial Field. McNabb's touchdown pass, 45 yards. Check this out. 24th pass of 20 or more yards in the first 4 games of the year. No quarterback's done that since Hall of Famer Dan Fouts 23 years ago. You talk about a landmark big play start to the season. McNabb and the Eagles have done just that. Robert Ferguson kickoff return, taken down at the 26-yard line by Omar Gaither, the backup linebacker. We go back to the touchdown.
That also has been the Achilles heel of the Green Bay Packers this year. They've given up, as Tony went through that litany of numbers,
49, 26, 35, 37, 42, and now you can add 45 to that, all giant bomb touchdowns.
And what Bob Sanders, the defensive coordinator of the Packers, told me, it's not that we're just giving up deep passes, but they're all touchdowns.
So Brett Favre, whose defense has given up 22 pass plays over 20 yards this year, has to get his team going on offense. Morency taken down at the 30-yard line. Pickup of 3 for Vernon.
You mentioned the tone in here changing. These Philadelphia fans were ready to they wanted something to cheer about. They'd lost two short touchdowns on fumbles. It's a great sports town. I know they're harsh and they boo a lot of people,
yeah,
but they come to every game in every sport. They support teams and they say to themselves, you represent us, get better. If you lose, we lose.
Favre on second and 7. Morris, he couldn't catch it. And it is intercepted. Defensive lineman going the wrong way. Lawan Ramsey needs a turn signal.
The rookie figured he was going somewhere with it.
Big momentum change. You can feel it in just in the last 2 minutes. Well, big momentum change.
And it all started with Donald Driver's drop of a
yes,
pass. I
mean, yes.
It all turned on that one play.
Good hands by Ramsey, the rookie out of USC, who backs up Mike Patterson, the second-year man out of USC, who had the 98-yard fumble return for touchdown last week in San Francisco. Meantime, the guy who made the hit on the intended receiver, Morency, Dahani Jones, is shaken up, and he was calling for the training staff to help him, and now he's getting up.
And that counts, obviously, as an interception against Favre.
Yep.
But your quarterback, Joe, that shouldn't count as an interception against Favre.
They're the most frustrated. Tip balls at the line of scrimmage, balls that go up in the air off of receivers' hands. There should be an asterisk next to those that denotes that it wasn't really all your fault. How am I doing, Mike?
That's the sort of
I'm trying to get a bunch of mine erased.
Not really all your fault.
No, it's like this one wasn't your fault completely.
Well, here are the Eagles with a golden opportunity to take a game that they were messing around in for 2.5 quarters, and after the last snap hitting the big play, a chance to get this drive to go up double digits.
Come back right now. Come back right now with it again.
Well, there was confusion from Philadelphia right at the start here, and they're forced to take what is their second time out of the half.
Donovan McNabb been a little erratic, but when he gets it right, he gets it right. Leading Dante Stallworth, L.J. Smith coming up. And then if it wasn't working with his arm, he's done it with his legs. Complete, playing so solid. Donovan McNabb's July 23rd is when they came to camp. We had a chance to talk to him in the second preseason game thereabouts, and they decided that at the Hall of Fame game, they were not going to try and build towards the season. That game, they came out, treated it like a regular season football game, and said, we're going to go out offensively and produce in this game, and it hasn't changed since.
This is the point I tried to make earlier. Donovan McNabb said, we're done with Terrell Owens. It's my team. We're going to be good from the jump. It's very important to him to be good right away.
And he was. And he is.
First down, play action, stop and go for Reggie Brown. Caught it, lost it, and it is ruled an incomplete pass. It's ruled incomplete on the field, and a penalty marker is down as Brown was running as well, and I think this is going to be on the Packers.
They're wearing out Ahmed Carroll. They are just, they have found a place that they want to go. Charles Woodson is not in the game, and they're going after Ahmed Carroll.
Interference, defense, number 28, first down.
Carroll, who was the first-round draft pick in 2004, not shy about having a conversation right throughout, and his lack of consistent play has made it even tougher on him in his first 3 years in the league.
Nice stop-and-go route by Reggie Brown. You can get pass interference on those plays 100% of the time now with the rules.
Penalty gives him 14 yards, and from the 30, right back to work in the underneath area. Lewis caught a touchdown last reception. Catches a touchdown this reception. Into the tunnel. Not Bo Jackson into the tunnel, but another 20-plus yard touchdown pass.
And he came back.
Is it too early to say this game is over?
Yeah, Brett Favre's on the other side of the
okay.
ball.
Exactly.
Yep.
Okay.
Sure feels like this game is over right now.
Woodson playing inside on the slot. And Greg Lewis, he had to be surprised when he got that clean into the open, turned around. There wasn't a Packer in the area.
And David Akers makes it a 15-point lead. Two Chicago kids have hooked up on back-to-back touchdowns. McNabb to Lewis.
Right, in the blink of an eye, Donovan McNabb has gone from having an average to maybe subpar game to suddenly probably being over 150, 250 yards by now. Everything he has done in this half has been absolutely correct. And you have the touchdown, then there's an interception, then there is another touchdown. And I know you want to say it's not over, but it feels in this building now like this game is over, that the Eagles can do nothing wrong. And it looked like in the first half they could lose a game at home to a team they believed they were clearly superior to.
That
Nab has jumped up and by running and passing taken the game on his shoulders.
That's what makes this next drive by the Packers so vitally important for Brett Favre.
But the last one appeared to be vitally important, and then there was an interception. I wouldn't count it against Favre either, but Favre had chances to score twice in this half, or you thought he needed to score because he's Brett Favre.
But you have to have help.
I'll go back. Can't have your wide receiver dropping passes.
Donald Driver not catching that ball on first and 10 created a domino effect for what's happened. You can always look at one play that sort of starts it moving.
Greg Lewis caught back-to-back touchdowns for the Eagles. Lewis, 46 games in the NFL with one touchdown, and he caught two touchdowns in the last three offensive plays for the Eagles. Akers kickoff, Corin Robinson return. Met right at the 20, Sean Considine, the backup defensive back, and Jason Avant.
Joe, you talked about how Favre needs to have a big drive here. We talked to Favre the other day about circumstances like this when the team is down, and he said, guys on the bench look to me. And they say, okay, Brett, this is when it's your time. This is where you make your money. And his comment was, it'd be nice to have some help. You know, thanks for laying it on me. How about helping me out a little bit?
Well, this is his time. The reason why is he's done it so many times before.
We're down 15 with about 19 minutes left in the game. She will run it and spin it for about 7 yards. A penalty marker comes down.
Holding. Offense. Number 73. 10-yard penalty. First down.
It's on Darren College, the rookie guard, and here's Michelle.
You guys keep mentioning that drop pass by Donald Driver. He is desperate to redeem himself. He came off the field after this drop pass so frustrated, threw his helmet into the bench, sat down, kicked the bench, just ruminated in disgust, wouldn't talk to anybody. But when they came back on the field for the next possession, he did go directly to Brett Favre as if to say, please come back to me.
He's been there for him before. Only Antonio Freeman has caught more Brett Favre passes in his NFL career. Driver, second on the Favre all-time catch list. Incomplete for Bubba Franks. Eagles defense looking as aggressive as it has all night.
They sense blood in the water. It's what they do. They feed. It becomes a feeding frenzy. Now all of a sudden the defensive linemen can take it up a notch and not really concern themselves a whole lot with the run. Go after Brett Favre. That's all they're thinking at this point.
And remember, Philadelphia has its starting quarterback Leo Shepard and its nickelback Roger Hood both out tonight. Favre has missed on 7 of his last 8 passes. Second and 20 down the middle with a flag down for Driver. It is intercepted. And Lewis is pushed out of bounds at the 25-yard line, but again, that flag came down in the secondary.
Right, Mike, when you get a flag that far down the field, in all likelihood, it's either going to be holding or pass interference.
Illegal contact while the quarterback was in the pocket. Number 22, defense, 5-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Marcelo Johansson, the corner out of Texas Tech, who got the start with Shepard and Hood, hurt tonight.
Or illegal contact. One of those three.
Same family.
They're going to wind up with a penalty that's going to give them a first down. That's as big as any completion that Brett Favre could have.
Sure, because it keeps the drive.
Yeah. And it quiets the fans down. Inside receiver,
by the
Donald
way,
Driver.
There was an interception on that that's obviously negated, but Philadelphia was going to come back, and I think they were going to score again.
But they're going to have to wait now.
Sure.
Robert Ferguson becomes the third receiver here. And the first down completion to the tight end, Bubba Franks, gets it to the 25-yard line. For whatever reason, it feels like there's 3 minutes left in the game. The Packers are out of the gun so much, but if you haven't seen Mike McCarthy's team play against Detroit, New Orleans, and Chicago, and Joe alluded to it before, much more shotgun because of the youth in the middle, two rookie guards, and a center who essentially is playing in his second year as an NFL starter, and Scott Wells. One more time to Franks. First down.
Brett Favre out of a shotgun, and we're looking at him in all likelihood in the shotgun for the remainder of this quarter, mostly the fourth, will be able to drop back and throw the ball effectively like this. Remember, the Eagles gave up some big leads, and in the last half, second half of the last couple of ball games, lost that one to the Giants they should have never lost.
The secondary, the inability to run and have sustained drives, have allowed the Giants and the 49ers to come back against Philadelphia late third, early fourth quarter. Big ball for Jennings. The rookie out of Western Michigan could not haul it in. Dawkins in wing covering. We'll have second down coming up.
Ryan Dawkins becomes weapon X when he gets on the football field. Easy, just an easygoing, quiet-talking guy. All of a sudden, he hits the football field, and he becomes a madman. And they have him play in a different position, a lot like Troy Polamalu, closer to the line of scrimmage.
Second down run, and Dawkins is the one who shuts it down, getting Vernon Morency to force third down.
Brian Dawkins is excited, long yardage, up around the line of scrimmage, just going towards it. Doesn't get blocked. Playing similarly, like I said, to Troy Polamalu with the Pittsburgh Steelers.
I like how you asked, I'm sorry, Joe, you asked him, did you negotiate with Jim Johnson, maybe some suggestions? Is it just a little? Favre, down the middle, Driver, hold it in. That time, for the first down at the 43-yard line.
Good job by that offensive line of the Green Bay Packers, giving Brett Favre the opportunity to get the ball up the field.
This is the reason you come to see him, isn't it? I mean, he's down, 15 points, and you say to yourself, whenever Brett Favre is out there, you've got a chance to score. I mean, even when he throws interceptions, it's usually exciting. He's an exciting star player.
After the gain of 26, I don't want that short one. I want the long one.
And then you get the pick
in return. Michael Lewis taking out the 34.
But it was exciting as I try to cover myself on that.
Brett's so mad at himself. He wanted to go to the right, then he wanted to hit the swing to the left. And all of a sudden, David Martin appeared in the middle. But Michael Lewis is waiting for him. To the right he goes. No. Back to the left. No. Now, he sees David Lewis, but David Martin. There's Michael Lewis, and he knew it.
And you saw the great immediate shot of Mike McCarthy, and that's the talk. Take the check down and be patient, or do what Tony's begging for. Hit the home run. Well, and a lot of times when you swing for the fence, you swing and miss.
And that's always been Favre's MO, and he's always defiantly defended that, saying, you know, I'm trying to win all the time. He's got to make up at least two scores, so
but
he goes for it.
But he's been very patient. That was just a bad throw. Bad read, bad decision.
Kick around Buckhalter, who's fumbled a couple of times. Watched Ryan Motes run wild. He comes in and runs for 15 first down yards. As Ryan Pickett brings him down as we spin down to the end of the third quarter.
The Eagles suddenly look very healthy in this game, don't they? Making defensive plays, making offensive plays.
And they're running they're running like a sugar huddle, like the way Boomer Esiason used to run it in Cincinnati.
What does that mean?
Means that everybody sort of mulls around near the line of scrimmage, and then they decide to call a play. And so instead of going all the way back to a true huddle.
Why is that called a sugar huddle?
Because that's what Boomer wanted to call it.
Oh.
Is that okay?
Well, you guys get to the deep meaning of that. We get to the end of the third quarter. Back-to-back touchdown passes for Greg Lewis. A 17-point quarter for the Eagles. A bunch of Packer miscues has allowed Philadelphia to lead by 15. Philadelphia, the Eagles with a 17-point third. Erase a two-point halftime deficit, and Donovan McNabb and company are up 15. 15 minutes away from T.O. week. Dallas comes on in here on Sunday.
The circus comes back into town.
From midfield, they give to Buckhalter. Gains 8 yards as A.J. Hawk and Nick Barnett give him a linebacker combo to the ground.
Green Bay defensively is quite young. A.J. Hawk, their number one pick out of OSU, is everything that they expected to be. He runs well. Does a lot of good things. Very, very happy with him. Then you go, you know, Brady Papingo on the other side, just in his second year. Nick Barnett only in his fourth. Linebackers all run well.
Again, the Eagles do not huddle. Run very close to the first down line at the 40 with Ryan Motes.
It was great to hear you say, dripping with disgust, that we're going to start T.O. week as soon as this game is over in 15 minutes. That's going to be the focus for the entire country.
You're not going to go there yet, are you? You're not going to go there yet.
Come on, I told you 20 minutes ago I thought this game was over. We got to move
It's not.
Terrell Owens comes back to Philadelphia. And by the way, everybody here hates him. Everybody in the stands.
You think?
Oh, they're screaming all the time. But do you listen to talk radio in this town?
Here's something else, though. Donovan McNabb texted T.O. this week to make sure that he was okay.
Very nicely he did that.
He still has a lot of guys in this locker room that care about him. Everybody cares about him as a person.
Well, of course, it was.
Here's the player.
Yeah, the week of intrigue Tuesday with we're not exactly sure what to correctly call. The police call the 911 Owens, and the entire situation was, what was the reaction to the medicine? Was it depression? Was it sadness? In any case, he came back with what everybody forgot was the broken bone in his hand. Came back quick, 5 catches, 88 yards in the Dallas demolition of Tennessee.
Wonderful compliment to Terry Glenn.
Buckhalter carries for a couple of yards. And you talk about Terrell Owens, and obviously returning to Philadelphia for the first time. He was here for 2 days shy of 2 years as an Eagle. His impact, they were 17-4 when he played. And there's a lot of stories to go with the without T.O. column. The sports hernia for McNabb, other injuries. But they were rolling with him, and when he wasn't here, it was part of the demise.
To be fair, McNabb was hurt, and McNabb was out for a lot of that 2-9. But when they were together, when it worked great. They brought Owens in here to get to the Super Bowl. They hadn't been able to get past the NFC Championship game 3 years in a row. They got to the Super Bowl in Owens' year. He didn't play in the championship game. Then he played in the Super Bowl and played great. And he had been hurt.
McNabb stepping up and throwing for Brown as the flag comes down. Reggie hauls it in as he's pushed out of bounds. And he is shaken up after the grab.
To get to what Joe said before, we were told by Donovan McNabb, I texted him, I told him I continue to send blessings.
Defense, penalties declined, first down.
I'll just continue with this. I continue to send blessings to you and your family, and he also concluded it by saying, if you need anything, just call. That was very charitable by Donovan McNabb.
It's called
given
class.
Given everything that had happened between the two of them.
It's called class. Donovan McNabb is the epitome of class. Oh, and Ahmed Carroll is being roasted, toasted, and taken advantage of all night.
Yeah, and the Eagles certainly hope that that injury to Reggie Brown is not something serious and long-term. He comes off to the bench in some pain. Jason Avant, the rookie fourth-round draft pick on the field as a receiver for the first time, as McNabb buys time and runs and rolls, going toward the end zone, gets in. Touchdown, Donovan.
I don't think the ball broke the plane of the goal line. He steps across, but that ball is in the right hand.
But
outside.
As long as any part of his body gets inside the pylon, it's a touchdown. The foot does. Remember the Mike Vick play on Monday night last year,
yep,
when he dives in and his left hand is in the pylon?
Because the goal line extends all the way out.
To Pluto.
Yeah, it's infinite. It's infinite. The goal line goes around the world.
I thought it was one of those big things up in the sky.
Is it okay if I ask you again, do you think it's over yet?
You know,
getting closer.
Okay.
You know, where's your sense of timing? Akers adds the extra point, 31-9. McNabb's second TD run. First time in his career that he's done that. I was about to say going to break. T.O. week has officially begun. Coverage from Philadelphia tonight brought to you by Goodyear. Great look in here at this stadium. It opened a few years ago on a Monday night. The Eagles with 24 here in the second half have made it comfortable, trying to improve to 3-1. And Robert Ferguson's kick return brought down 25. Avant, Quentin Michael in on the stop. Donovan McNabb's had a terrific half, sharing it with the Philly faithful. The Eagles have scored on all four possessions they've had here in the second half. Green Bay has been shut out, just a missed 54-yard field goal. Closest they've got to score. This drive starts from the 25. And Favre to Vernon Morency, wrapped up very quickly by Sean Barber, who came over from Kansas City in free agency.
It's unlikely that Favre is going to lead the team back and win this game, but I still think that he's got great star quality and people root for him, and one of the reasons they root for him is because they've seen him in both triumph and tragedy through his career, not just winning the Super Bowl, but, you know, having terrible things happen in his personal life as well.
Second and 11. Favre's toss to the sideline is hauled in by Corin Robinson. Flag comes in. We'll see if it's a catch or offensive pass interference. I think it's going to be against Robinson.
Offensive at this point?
Yes. But a heck of a catch anyway.
Interference. Offense. Number 81.
I was talking about
penalty. Second down.
The things that have happened to Favre. His addiction to painkillers. The announcement that his wife had cancer. His father's death. His brother-in-law's death. His mother's house ruined by Katrina. All of these things conspire in some strange way to make Favre seem more human than most of the people. He's one of the few guys in the NFL who you know without a helmet. And he said the other day, he said that with all, he knows that all the people have the same problems. And when it happens to me, people say, this guy is just like me. And that's one of the reasons I believe that he's beloved. And he's come around to seeing that as well, because he knows everybody likes him.
After the flag from the 14, another flag comes down as Jennings makes the catch out near the 21-yard line. And Tony, so many of those happened after Brett Favre was a Super Bowl winning quarterback. Right. And so many became public during or right around the football season. So it was day in, day out, living with some of the public drama and trauma that the Favre families had to deal with.
It was an unforgettable
formation. Offense, six men on the line of scrimmage, 5-yard penalty, second down.
And Mike, when you think of Monday night games, the Monday night game following his father's death, when he was so spectacular, I mean, people remember that. They'll remember that for years.
Father Irv passing away suddenly, Green Bay out in Oakland. And Favre, after consultation with his wife, deciding to stay there, play the game, and play an all-time on-target game. Robinson did a nice job to help Sheldon Brown not come away with an interception as Favre took the back end of that. December 22nd, 03 at Oakland. And Favre just was on target, just throwing balls, double coverage, triple coverage, yeah, everything. And they were just in the perfect spot. It was as if the angel was on his shoulders that night.
Yeah. And he's not going to win this one.
Well,
he's not going to have that kind of night tonight.
The other thing is, we all remember the Donovan McNabb third down and 26 completion. And now, or it was fourth and 26. Now we have a third and 26 here for Brett Favre.
That was in the divisional playoff, January 2004, to Freddie Mitchell. Packers were leading, Eagles tied the game, then won it eventually on a field goal. Incomplete here, and we'll have fourth down.
The Eagles just asserted themselves in the second half. Whatever Andy Reid said to them at halftime, the point was taken, because they came out with a different enthusiasm, a different tempo to their game.
Favre 5 for his last 15, been intercepted twice, and John Ryan on to kick. Returnable line drive, 38-yarder. Dexter Wynn on the run to the 30-yard line. With A.J. Hawk and Ahmad Carroll waiting to bring him down. Every time they've been on the field, McNabb and the offense have scored in the second half. Philadelphia Eagles, a playoff team every year from 2000 through 2004, then the 6-10. Last place finish, six starters lost last year, four Pro Bowlers lost, and so many questions. This team picked by some to be last in the NFC East. The motivation for Philadelphia, with an easy schedule at the start, relatively speaking, to get out of the gate quickly, and they have so far. Here's Karell Buckhalter with a carry. Gains about 2 yards to the 28. We have a SportsCenter 30-30 for you now with Matt Warner. Matt.
Mike, the end of baseball's regular season means playoffs for some and pink slips for others. There are managerial openings in San Francisco and the north side of Chicago. Felipe Alou and Dusty Baker were each with their teams 4 years. And the NFL suspended Titans defensive tackle Albert Haynesworth 5 games for stepping on Andre Giron. SportsCenter right after Monday Night Football.
Okay, Matt, thank you. ESPN News with updates at all times. Of course, the suspension, as we told you at halftime, the longest suspension for an on-field incident in the NFL. McNabb hides the ball, look deep, now takes off, and then throws incomplete. Down to Susie.
Mike, the Eagles may be up on the scoreboard, but they're down on the injury report. Before the game, we found out about injuries to the secondary and running back, and now the wide receiving core has taken 2 hits. On this reception, Reggie Brown suffered an injury to his shoulder. They took him into the locker room for x-rays. On top of that, Dante Stallworth, who's been plagued by a right hamstring strain, is out again, and he has worked so hard to dispel the rumors that he is always injury prone. He spent hours, endless hours at the facility. But when you're hurt, you're hurt.
So, Susie, that's Stallworth, Reggie Brown, Brian Westbrook, and go back to the first and third corners on this team, Lito Shepard and Roderick Hood. McNabb trying to get away from A.J. Hawk. He won't. Aaron Kampman will join him on the sack.
The Green Bay defense, other than their secondary, has done an excellent job up front putting pressure. A.J. Hawk coming on the blitz against Will Thomas, William Thomas, sliding around, unrelenting on Donovan. Donovan is just a load to bring down.
Fourth sack of the night. A.J. involved in that one. Of course, A.J. now married to Laura Quinn, the sister of Brady Quinn, the Notre Dame quarterback. They have settled in and bought a house in Green Bay. And A.J. had a great line, and I think it was the Green Bay Gazette, the newspaper. He said, "We're kind of waiting for our parents to come home. You know, they were in college and dating, and here we are. We have a house, and everything's great. And
feeling old.
When does everybody else come home? It's not the frat living with the Ohio State football players anymore." Touchback there. He's going to be a good player. Fifth overall pick of the draft last year. 9:09 to go. Fourth quarter. Well, you've seen the faces all year, and now 8 teams have survived. There's one championship to be had, and the Major League Baseball playoffs start tomorrow right here on ESPN. Athletics and Twins at 1 Eastern, the Cardinals and Padres at 4 Eastern. Donald Driver on the first down catch for 4 yards to the 24. So let me set the lineup for you for tomorrow. 1 Eastern, Barry Zito and the A's against Johan Santana and the Twins. That'll be at the Metrodome. And at 4 Eastern, St. Louis and the NL West champion San Diego Padres as the divisional series begin on ESPN. And every baseball playoff game from now until there's a world champ on ESPN Radio, as it has been the last 9 years. Morency with the run. And Vernon Morency gets a first down at the 31. Matt McCoy out of San Diego State made the tackle. Tomorrow, by the way, no more appropriate day to start the baseball playoffs. It's the 50th anniversary of Don Larsen's perfect game.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's one of the very few autographs that I have purchased. One of the very few.
Larsen
with the scoreboard behind him as Dale Mitchell is out on the third strike. 0-0-0.
Yogi Berra was the catcher?
Yes, for sure.
I have a ball signed by both of them.
From the 32, Brandon Myrie, the big hit by Dahani Jones. Michelle, what about the Packers here tonight?
Well, it's not a good night for Robert Ferguson is the bottom line. The wide receiver, you remember in the first half, went out with a rib injury, got x-rayed and came back. Now he's done for the night with a foot injury. How long that lasts, we don't know. But this is on top of, again, Amon Green being out for the night with his second hamstring in as many weeks. So Brett Favre has been without a couple of offensive weapons tonight, Mike.
Green Bay goes to plays St. Louis at home next week. Morency got a nice block from Jennings, the receiver, to give him space to get that first down out at the 42-yard line.
We get these injury reports of all the people on the Packers and all the people on the Eagles who are hurt in this game and will not play again.
Right.
That leads you to talk about Brett Favre, who has started 225 straight games as a quarterback. The next guy, Peyton Manning, would have to play into 2012 to catch him if Favre stopped now. It is an absolutely astonishing streak, given that it's football and given that he's a quarterback.
Pass is incomplete. Intended for Corin Robinson. Well, here's where the quarterback streak top 5 list is. Marino, Joe Ferguson of the Bills, our colleague Ron Jaworski did it here, 77-84. Peyton Manning still going, but he has a long way to go and a lot of time to go to get to Brett Favre, who's meter is still running at 225.
Favre said he didn't think about it much until the last 2 years. In every game he started in the last 2 years, he said he thought, this is amazing, because he knows how difficult it is. And he played a bunch of games with a broken thumb on his throwing hand.
2 years ago, it was incredible to watch.
Second down and 10. Morency, Joe, you did that first or second game right after Favre busted his thumb, right?
First game after,
yeah.
And you could see he actually had a splint on it. He tried to throw without it, he couldn't, but actually had a splint on the top half of his thumb. And to watch him grip the ball, when you think about from a quarterback stand, when you have the splint on this part of your thumb, that's where you have to put your hand, and the ball constantly comes slapping up into it. So it's not like you're just holding onto the football. You're handling it. You're getting it snapped on, and when you hand it off, people grab on it. It was phenomenal what he did in that year with that thumb.
Third and 7, Packers without a touchdown tonight. Favre's arm was hit as he put that up, and Corin Robinson just knocked it away again from Sheldon Brown. Jaquay Thomas came in there and hit Favre, who again was slow to scrape himself up.
One of the things Favre said is he said he thought that something would happen. There'd be an accident of some sort out of football, and he is slow going to the sidelines.
Mm-hmm.
Holding, he's being held up to some degree. He said that maybe there'd be something on a hunting accident, like he'd fall out of a tree stand. I don't know how often that happens.
Well, he was up spraying bees the last time and had a problem with it. There's one across the arm and the shoulder.
Yeah, he was very slow, and they stopped the clock to help him have time to head off to the sideline before this punt. Yeah, Joe, you're right. He was telling both of us down on the field before the game that he was up spraying bees before the New Orleans game, and he ended up cutting his finger.
Well, the bees started coming at him, and like the tree stand, his hunting stand, was like a going through a manhole, and he was sliding down. He slit the finger on his right hand. He was all wrapped up and bleeding.
It's Aaron Rodgers. I wonder if he gets in this game.
Well, he's going to get in because behind him, you see Brett Favre sitting there. A little bit out of it.
You know, the Packer training staff around him. And Jeff Garcia is going to come in here for the Eagles at quarterback.
Of course, Jeff Garcia was T.O.'s target before Donovan was, and the two of them roomed in training camp together. Wouldn't you have loved to have been a fly on the wall and listen to that conversation between those guys?
Garcia, three-time Pro Bowler, has thrown 126 career touchdown passes. And Mike McMahon was the backup here. When McNabb got hurt last year, their quarterback situation was not very strong. They saw that in action, so Garcia comes in for his first work. And as you see Favre over there on the sidelines, with both starting quarterbacks likely done for the night. Here's the hit on Favre. Again, it was Juquay Thomas coming in.
Hits it right on his right arm. And then, of course, he hits his head on Chad Clifton's bottom. He's all right. He's okay. 226 next week.
Well, Garcia struggles getting it to Motes, and Ryan will come back on it at the 15-yard line.
That'll qualify as the third fumble for the Eagles in this game tonight.
You got Favre coming back next week, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What do you think's the more amazing streak, the Cal Ripken streak, which is about, is it about 2,500 in baseball?
Shy, yes.
Yeah, and what do you, or this one, which is the more amazing streak, or is that apples and oranges?
I think it's a little bit of apples and orange, but I would think football is, because I can't imagine Cal breaking his thumb and going out and trying to throw a ball, grab a bat.
Right.
And these are things that Brett has played through. I'm sure Cal had his share of injuries.
On third and 10, that's incomplete. Sorry,
not John. Ones that stop you from being able to go out and play, Mike. What do you think?
I think the Favre streak. Again, like any one of them is bad. And they look at all the different starting quarterbacks since Favre's first start. And
incredible.
If he starts next week, you can add another one, because Matt Leinart's supposed to start for Arizona. So you know, Vince Young comes in, Matt Leinart comes in, all these guys come in, and you know, Favre, like the sun comes up, shows up one more time when the Packers take the field on offense for the first time.
Both streaks are amazing, but I tend to agree with Joe that in baseball you could not play in the way that Favre has played with that similar injury.
And the former Heisman Trophy winner, Charles Woodson, with the return out to the 46-yard line. One of a half dozen former Heisman Trophy winners to wear the Packer uniform. The Ravens and the Broncos next Monday night. How terrific the Ravens have been. Steve McNair joined us earlier. They're 4-0. Denver 2-1. And we saw Denver get going a little bit on offense in New England with Jake Plummer and Javon Walker. So that's next Monday night, 8:30 Eastern from Denver. And, of course, our coverage will be starting at 3 Eastern with Monday Night Countdown on site from Invesco Field at Mile High, beginning at 7 Eastern.
Aaron Rodgers in to take over at quarterback.
Hands off to Morency. Aaron taken 24th overall pick, first round of last year's draft. And there was much made last year, as Rodgers only threw 16 passes, completing 9 of them. Much made about, well, is Brett Favre going to be his mentor? How much is Brett Favre going to hold his hand during training camp and during the season? That became a pretty significant issue as time went on, and I think this year their ability to coexist is a little more comfortable all the way around.
Communicate is really what's happened this year a lot more. Aaron feels more comfortable asking Brett questions. Brett very happy to comply with them. Aaron told me a year ago it was very uncomfortable sitting in a meeting. And starting quarterbacks, John Elway, Dan Marino, Brett Favre, you're not really there to mentor anybody. You're there to do a job, and that's win football games. It's the coach's job to mentor. You can make it a comfortable transition, but it's still his job. And you have to wonder, is it the shoulder? Is it the head? Is Brett going to be up for 226?
Rodgers completes it to Morency, tackled by Omar Gaither.
Rodgers also has a gun. for an arm.
But do you think that Brett Favre will show Rodgers how to spray bees?
No.
Because, see, that's a new one on me, to spray bees.
Get the bees out of, you got to get them out of your deer stand, Tony.
I don't, this may come as a shock to you, Joe. Yeah. Living in Washington, D.C., I don't have a deer stand.
I have, I'm one behind the farm. Uh-huh. You got to get one.
Here's a nice quick pass by Rodgers to Corin Robinson, and Michelle, it's a first down at the 27.
Officially they're calling this a head injury on Brett Favre, and it's a coach's decision to pull him out. But I will tell you this, purely from an observational standpoint, Mike and you guys, that he has talked to a couple of different trainers and showed the trainers on their shoulders where he appears to be hurting on his own shoulder. So officially a head injury, but indications from my observation, a shoulder injury.
And Michelle, of course, will watch through the short week as they get ready for St. Louis on Sunday. Pass incomplete from Rodgers, intended for Greg Jennings, with 2:06 to go.
Aaron Rodgers is in one of those very unenviable positions. Even when you do get the chance to play, look at the shoes that you're going to have to try and fill. And think of the difficulty that people have had coming in and playing behind John Elway, behind Dan Marino. The legacy that has been created.
You never want to follow the legend. You want to be the person who follows the next guy after the legend.
Right.
I mean, Jake Plummer, as he had his success in Denver last year, was the Elway comparisons. In Miami, it's still going on, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Who's going to be the guy to replace Skinny? Dan Marino has the most touchdown passes of all time, 420. Favre at 402, but none tonight. Two-minute warning. A great aerial look at Center City, Philadelphia, from the Goodyear Blimp, providing our aerial coverage here tonight, just 4 miles south of Center City. Straight shot down Broad from City Hall brings you down here. All right, so guys, check this one out. Steve Hurd, who always gives us these great numbers, has a beauty here. Eagles trailed at the half. They lead by 22. The Eagles have never trailed at half and gone on to win a game by 20 points or more, ever in their history.
Well, the Packers score, it won't happen again.
The Eagles' history goes back to 1933. They played their second road game ever at Green Bay. Intended for Greg Jennings, and pass interference is going to be called here on Dustin Fox.
Yeah, when you're hanging on to a guy's jersey running down the field, it's probably going to get you a flag. Now, keep in mind, the Packers haven't won in Philadelphia only since 1962.
Interference, defense, number 21. First down.
It's 8 times in that stretch.
That's not like they played twice a year here.
No, that's true. Still, they haven't won since that time.
Although via, you know, the scheduling and the similarities in the two teams over the last few years, they have played for 4 consecutive years, all here in Philadelphia, because they both won their division in those 3 prior years and both finished last year. Vernon Morency. He is stopped, submarined at the 1 yard line. With a minute 55 to go. You see, Lombardi was the head coach for the last win that the Packers had in Philadelphia in 62. It was a 49-0 win.
They would have liked to have saved some of those points for here.
Morency stopped right at the goal line again.
Now this becomes important to the Eagles to stop them on the goal line. You see guys get juiced up. You know the game's been decided, but the defensive line of the Green Bay Packers, excuse me, of the Philadelphia Eagles, they're saying, look, we don't want you to score.
Well, the Eagles had a goal line stand against San Francisco that led to the Mike Patterson return for touchdown last week. Morency, by the way, is sitting on 99 yards. If he can pop this in, he'll have a 100-yard night as well. I might be shy there as they run in. Let's see. They take a peek and say
he's
fourth
short.
Down. Yeah.
He's short.
Fourth down. Of course, in the last 2 minutes, any reviews via replay come from the booth. Not the challenge. That one looked to be shy right from the start.
Good job by the guys up front.
They'll start the clock, and it's fourth down and one more shot at it.
Mike McCarthy is trying to prove a point with his football team. Short yardage becomes a matter of will. Question is, can you get your guys to will their way and block the people in front of them?
Morency one more time. Omar Gaither leads the charge. Ball comes out. They are stopped. And even with Brian Dawkins on the bench, the Eagles defense stands tall. A very fitting way for this night to come to an end.
It was important to the Philadelphia Eagle defense to keep them out. They got lower than the Packer line.
Wow.
Gethers does a nice job taking Morency in the air to the ground.
It was important to Steve Hurt's statistic to keep him out as well. I mean, he looked that thing up. He went all the way back to the beginning of the franchise. Did you say 1938?
33.
Hurt's breathing a sigh of relief that they didn't get in there.
Also got one other for you here tonight on the way out. The Packers had four sacks of McNabb.
Yes.
The Eagles did not sack Favre, okay? First time you had four sacks to none, that kind of a situation, and a team winning a game by 20 since 1971, which is the only other time it happened in NFL history. So it's a rare, rare night all the way around for the Eagles.
Must be a full moon then.
Well, it's darn close. Well, they will get to enjoy it for 7 minutes. The fifth question in the press conference will be about Terrell Owens. And the Cowboys are on their way to Philadelphia. Favre and the Packers are 1-3. The Eagles are 3-1. 31-9, Philadelphia wins. We see you next week from Denver, the undefeated Baltimore Ravens against the Broncos. SportsCenter is next on ESPN with Michelle Tafoya, Susie Kalman, Joe Theismann, Tony Kornheiser, and the women and men of our Monday Night Football crew, Mike Tirico, saying thanks for watching this presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. And off we go to SportsCenter.